Hello, everyone, and welcome to another edition of Mormon Stories Podcast. I'm your host, John DeLynn. It's May 10th, 2021. And today I am so super excited for our interview. I have a dear friend in Houston, Texas. He's actually in Sugar Land. His name is Jason Moore. Jason, his parents, the Moores, have been dear friends as well, the whole family. It was Lynn Moore who recommended that I interview Mike Rinder for Mormon Stories Podcast that led to both me interviewing Mike and then Mike and Leah Remini having me on Fair Game Podcast, the ex-Scientologists. And that, so the Moore family, they've hosted several faith crisis retreats or events down in Houston and Sugar Land. But my buddy Jason, for some reason, my buddy Jason, who lives in Sugar Land, Texas as well, we're the exact same age. We both grew up in Houston at the exact same time. My buddy Jason has been a big fan of Jehovah's Witness, ex-Jehovah's Witness podcasts, and particularly he's been a big fan. Well, he recommended that I interview Lloyd Evans a couple years ago, an ex-Jehovah's Witness. And then he's been a big fan of these two guests that I'm going to have on today, JT and Lady Cee. JT and Lady Cee are active in the ex-Jehovah's Witness YouTube community, and I'm sure they do a lot of other cool stuff as well. But my buddy Jason's been just telling me for over a year, John, you got to interview JT and Lady Cee. And we almost did it right before COVID, but then COVID made everything weird. And I'm just now getting back into kind of this backlog. So without any further ado, JT and Lady Cee, I am so excited to have you on Mormon Stories Podcast. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you so much for having us. We're glad to be here.
Yeah, we finally able to coordinate and get together. It's been a long time, but we've been looking forward to it.
Well, thank you. And I've been watching your YouTube channel. Why don't you guys just quickly tell everybody what it is you guys do as let's just say ex-Jehovah's Witness activists. Those are my words, not yours. Tell everybody about your channel, if you've got any books or websites or whatever, just as kind of an introduction, and then we'll go back into your stories. Is that okay?
That's fine.
Sure.
Okay.
Sure. We have our website is xjwcriticalthinker.com, and if you want to go to YouTube and check out our videos, it's just XJW Critical Thinker. We are working on a book, have been for a while now. Hopefully that will be out soon. And basically, we've just been activists out on the internet for about, maybe 7 or 8 years now. But pre-internet, you know, going online with YouTube, we were on this bulletin board called jehovahswitness.net, where JT, he really was on that board more than me. And so he's probably has over 4,000 posts up there. So we did a lot of activism even before YouTube was popular or even came into existence.
You're kind of OGs, as they say.
Yeah, right. Yeah, pretty much. We decided to set up a channel, and we wanted to name it what we feel is probably the biggest challenge for people who are involved with the Jehovah's Witnesses, and that's the lack of critical thinking. One of the things that this religion will do is they will literally shut down your ability to think critically. And it's a very effective tool, because what they have done, they have very carefully made critical thinking questioning God. And so as a result, anything that they write, anything they publish, since it is from God, you can't do any critical thinking or asking too many questions. I tell people all the time, basically, you can ask all the questions that you want. You can ask all the questions that you want, but you just can't question the answers. And that's why we have on our website a little saying that I prefer to have questions that I cannot answer than to have answers that I cannot question. And so this is what we felt was probably the biggest thing as of what holds people into this religion or pulls them back and brings them in, is the inability to literally think critically.
I love it. So you guys were doing this before Lloyd Evans.
Yes.
That's amazing. Okay. Well, I'm sorry it took me so long to get you guys on, but I'm thrilled to have you today. Okay, well, I've got so many questions. We're going to try, we're going to have to kind of do a 3-hour interview today, just so our listeners know. We'll do as long as we can with a max of 3 hours.
Yes,
Okay, so let's begin with how you guys joined. I don't know if you were born into the church. I get a sense that your family converted after you guys were born. But tell us, let's begin by just how you guys ended up becoming Jehovah's Witnesses. And I'm sure each of you is going to have a slightly different story.
Yeah, I like to look at it as a doorstop witness. You know, my mother back probably in the 30s, you know, her father was contacted in the door-to-door work, the door-to-door, going out in field service, what they call it, field service, knocking on their door. And my grandfather was smitten by the Jehovah's Witnesses. And he even came home and said, look, the Christmas tree is wrong. We're going to throw this out the house. But he really didn't take to this religion. You know, he talked about Jehovah's Witnesses. He let his children study with Jehovah's Witnesses. And, you know, they were like touch and go with the Witnesses. And so basically, when my brother, I was younger than my brother, I was two, he was six. And my brother was tragically hit and killed in a car accident. He was on foot and he got killed by some people that were driving up and down the street racing cars. And my mom, you know, she pulled back into her memory bank. Hey, look, you know, there's these people. They talked about this paradise earth. You know, how can I get on this bandwagon? Because I want to see my son again. And so mom, you know, she had a Jehovah's Witness funeral for him. She contacted the elders at the Kingdom Hall. I want my son to be buried, you know, via Jehovah's Witnesses and all that kind of stuff. And so that's really where we got our start into, you know, becoming involved with this religion. Being raised, my father was in the military, he was in the U.S. Air Force. And after my brother was killed, he got orders to go to another duty location. And when we moved, my mom contacted the Jehovah's Witnesses after we got there. So this is, you know, all I've known, you know, since I was 2 years old. You know, we've been going, you know, she didn't get baptized until I was older. And, you know, she did, you know, still dabble in Christmas a little bit and stuff like that. But I think it was like I was seven when she got baptized, and we no longer celebrated any of these holidays. But basically, she never joined any other religion, never was a part of any other church. So I never really went to any other church. So the Jehovah's Witnesses is pretty much all I know.
Okay.
Yeah.
And that's so common. You know, it's so common for high demand religions in their missionary efforts. And you guys should know, I served a Mormon mission for 2 years in Guatemala. And when we have, I don't know, 50, 80,000 missionaries out across the world, at least in any given year, it's so common for missionaries to target people who have been through some sort of crisis, who are in poverty, who have had a death in the family, because when somebody is having those existential questions, will I see my loved ones again? How do I get out of poverty? How do I get out of addiction? People who are having real need are prime targets for missionary work. So that makes sense.
Yeah. In fact, that is one of the focal points of the Jehovah's Witnesses ministry. Many of the elders, like myself and others who have served as speakers, we will often incorporate into our talks something about when we go out and knock on doors, that we're not looking for everybody. We are not looking for everybody. In fact, we are very specific. We're looking for people who are moaning and groaning over the detestable things they see going around them, which makes it a perfect religion to bring people in who are struggling, like you just mentioned. And as far as myself, that's kind of how my mom became a witness. My mom grew up in the late 50s, early 60s, when civil rights was just really jumping off. She was very much involved in that. And her grandmother died. And so people want to get answers and so forth. So a witness knocked on my mom's door, older white lady, and she said, we're sharing the Bible, talking about the Bible. And down south where I'm from, people are religious. People have a great respect for the Bible. Whatever religion you are, generally speaking, if you're talking about the Lord and the Word of God, you're going to get in somebody's house. And so my mom, you know, talked to the lady, and there was a question that she asked the lady. She says, do you guys worship together? And the lady says, yes, we have an integrated church. And during this time, the Watchtower was just starting to integrate all of its congregation because of the passage of laws. They could do it now. And so my mom went to the Kingdom Hall. And like I said, living in North Carolina, living down south, especially with the little town I'm from, the little town I'm from has two churches. It had a Baptist church for white people and a Baptist church for black people. And it's been there probably, both of them have been there probably over 100 years. And to this very day, 2021, on Sunday morning, those two churches do not mix to go to services. And so when my mom went to the Kingdom Hall, she saw something, actually she heard something and saw it that she had never seen before in her life. She saw a white man reach out to a black man and say, good morning, brother. And at that point, it was done. This is the truth. This is the truth. And that started when I was about 5 or 6 years old. And like most witnesses, we grew up through the whole witness program as a kid going to school, not being able to do the holidays, you know, different activities in school, laughed at, sent down to the principal's office, to the library when they would celebrate holidays and so forth. I mean, that is literally the witness child path. Generally speaking, any Jehovah's Witness that you interview who has grown up in this religion from small child up to when they finish high school, this was the path that you walked. You walked the path of suffering, being kicked out of classes, laughed at, poked fun at, you know, you couldn't eat the Christmas cake, and it's difficult. And the thing that makes it work, and this is what a good Jehovah's Witness parent does to their child, when they come home, they will tell them, all those children that laughed at you today and poked fun at you today, that's okay. Jehovah got something for them. They're going to die at Armageddon. So it would take a child who was being treated this way. You would go back to school the next day, and when your classmates started poking fun at you, that, that's all right. Jehovah got something for you. And so, this is sad because when you think about this, you have a child who's in the first, second, third grade. They literally begin to look around at their classmates as dead men walking. Dead men walking. And this is what allows Jehovah's Witnesses to adopt that persecution complex. Because see, now you done heard about Daniel in the lion's den. You done heard about the three Hebrew boys. This is you. And a good Jehovah's Witness parent will inculcate this into their child. So when you look at people who are not witnesses, your next door neighbor, your coworker, now witnesses are generally very friendly. And this is what, and this is the catch 22. I mean, this, and we talked about this on our show. This is the catch 22. The public persona of a Jehovah's Witness is wonderful. He's a good man, wonderful man, good people. But the way in which they view you as they're standing at your door or when they walk away, or if you're on the job, they view you as dead man walking. And the average person who knows a Jehovah's Witness has no idea that this witness is saying to himself, unless you come in the truth, you ain't gonna get life. And so this is the whole mindset. And that creates that wonderful us versus you. And this is what carries on. One of the things that we stress on our show, because it's very important, there are two things that is crucial. I mean, and we can't stress this enough. There are two things that are very crucial. One is to understand and know Jehovah's Witnesses' teachings because they're very unique. But the second part, which is a little bit more difficult, and that's the culture. That's that culture that takes place that is not written down in a Watchtower or any Watchtower publication. This is the attitude, the disposition, the viewpoint, how they think. There is a culture in Jehovah's Witnesses that at sometimes is even more powerful. It has more influence on what you do and don't do than even something that's written in their publications. And so that is kind of where we come in with our channel, is to help people to understand that you need to literally dig up underneath the surface. They're standing on the front porch and everything, you know, nice little suit and tie, smiling and everything. But when you step behind, you get to see the man behind the curtain, and that makes a tremendous difference.
I love it. Yeah, I know there are a lot of Mormons and ex-Mormons nodding their heads right now. Just this idea of really nice people, good reputations, clean living, that's how we would describe how people see us as well. Maybe a little weird, but you know, good, kind people. But I was just going to say, I really connect with what you're saying, because like I grew up in Katy, Texas, which also was a Baptist town, as a Mormon. And you would think that all the persecution I received as a Mormon in a Baptist town maybe would have made me question my church or made me weaker in my faith. It made me stronger. Why are you shaking your head, JT?
Yeah.
Why are you nodding your head, Lady Cee?
You're right. Yeah. You're absolutely right. Right.
That's right.
And this is what you have said, man, is the most important thing. And the reason why is because of the basic teaching of high control groups. And you've seen it. David Koresh, all those high control groups of cults, they constantly tell their people, folks are going to hate you. In fact, let me give you a perfect example. My wife and I was laughing the other day. When a witness starts studying the Bible with someone, you come to someone's home and they let you come back every week to study. One of the things that you tell them is this. Now, let me explain to you that there are going to be those who will not like the fact that you are studying with us as Jehovah's Witnesses because you are learning the truth. And they're going to discourage you. They're going to tell you to not study with Jehovah's Witnesses. Then you know what happens? 2 or 3 weeks later, they're telling somebody in their family, "No, I'm studying the Bible with Jehovah's Witnesses." And the first thing the person says, "Man, you believe in the folks? You're crazy, man. You believe in the folks alone." And so all of a sudden, the person's like, "Oh my goodness, he don't even know my uncle." And he was right. That's exactly what he said was going to happen. And what that does, that provides the confirmation that you have the truth. And so you now view persecution as a badge of honor. And that is why witnesses have no problem going to jail, and because they think they believe everything they're doing is for God. And it brings to mind the statement that the apostle said, that there will come a time where people would deliver you up and kill you and think they did a service to God. And that is what makes, unfortunately, some religious belief systems so dangerous. Because once a man or a woman is convinced that what they are doing, and we saw this on 9/11, we saw this. Once a person is convinced that what they are doing is what God himself says, you can't stop them. That person, man or woman, unstoppable.
Right. But you know what I also found was the name Jehovah, because they like to play that card too. So like you would go to people's door and you would ask them, "Do you know what God's name is?" And you would take them to Psalms 83:18 and you would introduce them to Jehovah's name. And then all of a sudden, you know, they would be like, "My pastor, my preacher didn't tell me God's name was Jehovah." And so then, you know, they have this thing where now they're so devoted to this concept, to this name of God, and their preacher and pastor and priest and so forth didn't tell them about, you know, this name and all this kind of stuff. And then the Jehovah's Witnesses, the brothers who write the articles up at Bethel, when they start, you know, hearing about the grumblings and the moanings about people in the congregation, because, you know, they get the reports from the circuit overseer when they go to the congregations and they, you know, give the little 6-month report on the congregation. Then they write these little articles in the magazines about, you know, what people are talking about in the congregation. So they had this little article up, I remember a long time ago, and the article was like, "Where did you learn God's name?" So it's like, okay, so now you're going to pull that and put that in my face and say, "Oh, stop complaining, because we're the people who taught you that God's name is Jehovah." So they use a lot of little ways to, you know, play on your emotions, your feelings, and, you know, just that people feel like they're indebted to the Watchtower Society because of that one fact, you know. So right. It's a lot of stuff like that.
I love it.
My wife often talks about it reminds you of abused women. You have an abused woman and she may become involved with a man and he'll say, I pulled you out of the gutter. You want nothing before you knew me. And that's kind of the trick that the Watchtower plays on its members, because they will throw it in your face. Well, you wouldn't be here if it wasn't for us. If we hadn't stopped by and told you. And so you begin like an abused woman, like, "Yeah, that's true. I wouldn't be here." And all of a sudden you begin to question yourself whenever you begin to start thinking for yourself. They will quickly remind you, where were you before you found us? And so that's why I refer to it all the time, that as a Jehovah's Witness, you and yourself as a Mormon and anyone who's in a high control religious group, I mean, you're spiritually abused, man. I mean, you can call it what you want to, but you're spiritually abused. And it takes its toll on people, man. I mean, we see that. I saw that even when I was a witness. I was an elder, and man, the friends, the people would call just broken. And you knew you couldn't fix it because you had no training, but because you had this title and people just would listen to whatever you would say. And that's what makes it so dangerous, because you get a fool up there giving advice, man, you're in trouble. And unfortunately, you have a lot of fools out there. And so this whole idea that you can't make it without us, that runs deep. That runs very deep, very deep.
Yeah, and that is a classic abuse tactic. Yeah, okay, so let me ask you about conversion really quick, because, a lot of times, okay, we're taught as Mormons that you're converted by the Holy Ghost, that you get these warm feelings, and you feel the hair on your arm stands up, or the hair on your neck, you get a chill. And people, when they're with the Mormon missionaries, they're taught, when you feel those feelings of peace or love or joy or warmth, that's the Holy Ghost, number one. And that's the Holy Ghost testifying to you that the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints is the true church. How are Jehovah's Witnesses taught there to know that the church is the true church? And we'd like to hear your version of that.
Okay. Oh man, that is a great question. I am so glad that you brought it up. Notice you said that you get this feeling, and that's right. How you know that you're in the true church.
Yes.
Very important to understand that Jehovah's Witnesses cannot teach that. They can't teach that. You know why? Because Jehovah's Witnesses have two groups of Christians. They have two different sets of Christians. The only one who feels any warm and fuzzy, that's the anointed. God's spirit bears witness with their spirit. They're the only ones who can get any warm and fuzzy. If you're part of the great crowd and you're talking about you got some warm and fuzzy, witnesses will look at you like, oh boy, watch out. So it's interesting how in your religion, you know you're part of the true religion because you get the warm and fuzzy. How does a Jehovah's Witness know he's part of the true religion? Very simple. You complete the questions that the elders have for you to get baptized, and they say you now can get baptized. Because in order to get as baptized as a Jehovah's Witness, the elders will sit down with you and they will go over you a ton of questions. And once you complete all the questions and they get together, because they typically do three meetings, three different brothers get with you. And what they'll do, they'll go over a certain section, the next one go over a little section. Next, and if they get together, they say, I think he knows enough. I think he knows he's doing good. That's how you know you're part of the true religion. There is no warm and fuzzy.
That interesting.
And it's because the witnesses teach that there are two separate groups, and only the anointed have God's spirit bear witness with theirs. So you can't give that to the great crowd, man. You can't have great crowd folks talking about they feeling some warm and fuzzy.
Well, the closest thing that you're going to get to something like that is like when 9/11 hit and when the two twin towers went down. And the witnesses have been, you know, preaching this gloom and doom. All these Jehovah's Witnesses that had stopped going to the Kingdom Hall, everybody was flocking back to the meetings. Yeah. So, but they're to me, their warm and fuzzy is they have identified gloom and doom is ahead. Yeah. When gloom and doom appears, it's like, yes, they've been talking this for years, and now it's time to get back to Jehovah. That was my warm and fuzzy.
Yeah, that's kind of how, like right now with COVID, oh my goodness, man, when COVID hit, witnesses like, oh, the end is here.
Mm-hmm. Oh, wow.
They were talking about, you know, pestilence and sickness and death, and for the witness, this was the Holy Grail. And so that's the kind of stuff that they do. And of course, you know, like we was talking before and we did a couple of videos on, you know, I mean, COVID has come, and from everything that looks like, COVID is going to be pretty much moving on. And so what will happen is this will simply be another period in the march of humanity. And we know that because when you look at the start of this religion, they was hanging on to World War I, which was in 1914. The world was going to end. When the war broke out, the end was coming. The witnesses knew it. And here we are now, man, 100 and almost, you know, over 100 years later. And all those people back there who looked at what the Watchtower explained was these are the signs. They're all dead now, man. They're all dead. The Watchtower taught you had to be about 15 years old to understand what happened in 1914. Those people are all gone.
Right.
I love it. And yeah, go ahead, Lacey. Yeah.
I was going to say, circling back to the warm and fuzzy. Here's another warm and fuzzy for you. Okay, so Jehovah's Witnesses are told, be at your three meetings a week. Well, no, it's five. Well, it's different now because they changed things up. But when we were going, it was five meetings a week. So if you made your five, you felt warm and fuzzy.
Yeah.
If you went out in field service and you knocked on your fair share of doors every month, then you kind of felt warm and fuzzy. So if you were doing all of the things that Watchtower told you to do, those are kind of like your warm and fuzzies.
Yeah, that's the warm and fuzzy.
So kind of positive reinforcement for doing what you're told to do.
That's exactly right. Yep.
There's a good comment by somebody called Ex Jehovah's Witness Activism New Zealand. He actually writes, let's see, Jehovah's Witnesses claim to base their faith on facts, realities, and truth, or head knowledge only. And that's interesting because I think that's different than how people would describe their conversion to Mormonism. So that's interesting. And it's interesting because I think now you wouldn't quite call it facts and reality and truth, would you? You probably wouldn't call it that now.
Yes. We did a video. If you get a chance, we invite you to take a look at it. The video is called From Truth to Trash. I'm going to share some of this. This is the whole reason why we tell people you have to think critically. The Watchtower has had basically four past presidents. Do you know that under the first president, Russell, Rutherford, Knorr, and basically Frederick Franz, do you know that Jehovah's Witnesses do not use any of the books that was published under those four presidents because they have all been basically relegated to the trash can? In other words, when Russell was alive, he stood before tens of thousands of people and said, this book contains the truth. Man, that book is in the trash. Rutherford, in England, all around the world, stood before tens of thousands. This book contains the truth. It's in the trash now. Same thing with Nathan Knorr. And now Frederick Franz. Most of the books that Frederick Franz wrote are now either in the trash or heading to the trash. Frederick Franz, when I was at Bethel, I used to live down the hall from Frederick Franz. He lived on the ninth floor of the 124 Columbia Heights building.
Tell us what in Bethel means.
Bethel is basically the headquarters of Jehovah's Witnesses. Bethel means house of God. And so the Watchtower Bible and Tract Society refers to their headquarters as the house of God. And so to be invited to serve at Bethel in the Jehovah's Witness world, it is literally, and I mean this, it is literally the Jehovah's Witnesses version of Harvard and Yale. It really is. Because you're serving there with the governing body. When I was there, they used to tell us all the time, you brothers need to be very aware of how fortunate you are. At the time, there are 6 million Jehovah's Witnesses around the world. And only 6,000 work at the headquarters around the world. And so you were part of the 1%. And so you got to see the organization literally on a level that the average Jehovah's Witness will never in their life see. And so that was one of the things that kind of drove us to actually, we left in 1998, man, 1990, we were gone. People kept saying, JT, Lady C, y'all guys need to tell y'all a story, man. Y'all were involved in a lot of stuff that most witnesses don't know nothing about. I mean, y'all were involved in Bethel level, regional level, circuit level. Y'all guys saw a lot of stuff. You need to let people know some of the stuff that you knew. And so, because we was going to college, and so we decided, well, if we're going to set up a channel, we're going to set it up a certain way. We didn't want to get into debates with people. We simply wanted to simply provide you with information of what we lived and what we saw, what we experienced. And you can take it and leave it. Because I'm going to tell you, man, this is a business. Watchtower is a business. Watchtower just sold all their property in Brooklyn, New York, to the tune of $2 billion. The Brooklyn Heights has like a little newspaper They just recently, about a couple of years ago, they went down to Kings County and went through all the Watchtower properties and what it sold for. Over $2 billion the Watchtower cleaned out when they rolled up out of Brooklyn. And as you know, churches don't pay taxes. So the Watchtower, man, is a major corporation that just, I mean, the money side of this organization, man, is just unreal. I mean, it really is. It's amazing.
Yeah, yeah. There's that saying from L. Ron Hubbard, if you want to get rich, start a business. If you want to get really rich, start a religion. And
we kind of blew
Leah Remini and Mike Rinder, the ex-Scientologists, because I was listening to their podcast and they're like, Scientology is worth $2 or $3 billion. And I kind of blew them away because it was released a couple of years ago that just the cash, stock, and real estate investments of the Mormon Church exceeds $120 billion.
I believe it.
And that's not counting the actual church and its actual assets and real estate of all its churches and temples and all its operations. That's not counting that. That's just how much money and cash is in their investments, right? The Mormon Church owns 2% of the publicly available land in the state of Florida. 2%. So I'm not trying to flex on you guys, but I'm just saying, like,
oh yeah.
Yeah, like,
I mean, like you said, religion, man, religion is big business, man. I mean,
but see, the Mormons never said that they weren't trying to make money. But see, Jehovah's Witnesses, they have been, we're not after your money. And they really are. They really are. But because they don't really push college. See, you know, what I know about the Mormons, they do believe in going to
that's
college.
Right. Yeah, that's
Jehovah's
right.
Jehovah's Witnesses, you know, you can only get so much money from a turnip, you know. And I'm cleaning office buildings at night. I'm not going to be able to give you too much in donations.
Yeah, right. That's one of the things I do have to say about the Mormon Church, regardless of whatever you may feel about them. They did realize that we can get more money from people who got education and good jobs than
absolutely.
The Jehovah's Witnesses who got people with no education and low paying jobs. I mean, I got
yeah.
That was a good play. That was a good play.
All right. I love it. Okay. So when somebody converts to Jehovah's Witnesses, what do you think the main reasons are? We already talked about this a little bit. Maybe they've got a death in the family. Maybe they're poor. What do you think the main 3 to 5 reasons are when someone converts? What is it that gets them? Is it the community? Is it they feel the love? Is it their, you know, what is it? What causes people to convert?
It's a lot of things. Like my mom, the death of her son. I know people may go out into the world. They may get involved in drugs and they have gone through a bad life and maybe had a near-death experience. And now they're like, look, I'm going back to Jehovah because ain't nothing in this world. And we get people, you know, putting comments on our YouTube videos. And that was one of the reasons why someone came back, is because they had went out into the world and had gotten involved in all kind of stuff. And they said, I'm not ever leaving the religion again, because they felt it was a safety net. And then, you know, there's people that come back or getting baptized because, you know, they're just, maybe somebody got disfellowshipped, you know? And so then they want to get reinstated. They're coming back to go talk to their family. We even get people that write us emails because they're dating someone that's a Jehovah's Witness. And the only way they're going to marry them is they got to convert to the religion. So there's just all, I mean, when you think about it, it's anything from A to Z why people would become a Jehovah's Witness. Maybe they're afraid, you know, of dying. Maybe, like, I have an aunt who decided that she was leaving the religion. She had a conversation with me 10 years ago, and she said, I'll never go back, okay? So at this point, we're having a good conversations. We're talking back and forth. Aunt, niece, she's helping me get through caretaking my mom. My mom is sick. My aunt, she's like the shoulder I'm crying on, right? So all of a sudden, she gets this terminal illness. You know, she gets diagnosed with a terminal illness. Then all of a sudden, she's going back to the Kingdom Hall. And she found out that we have a YouTube channel, and she decided that enough was enough and too much was foolish. on her end. And so she cut me off and she cut my dad off. And so she went to her grave, not speaking another word to me. And we kind of like stopped talking 4 years before she died. So there's a lot of reasons why people go back to this religion or join.
Yeah. But my wife, the point she made, that they're just outstanding examples of the various reasons that people convert or go back. I think from a marketing standpoint, Jehovah's Witnesses have probably one of the better products that's being sold, religiously speaking. Many denominations teach that you're going to die, go to heaven, sit on clouds, play harps, eat honey and drink milk. That's typically what you are told in many denominations, what you will do when you go to heaven. Jehovah's Witnesses, they have a different product. Their product is paradise. Paradise. Something that you've seen, something you know what it looks like. You can go to Hawaii. You can go to the Caribbean islands. You can find out like all around the world. And so when you are living in what we refer to as the ghetto or the hood or whatever, and a Jehovah's Witness knocks on your door and they hold up that little magazine and they ask that magic question, would you and your family like to live in a place that looked like this? Now, only a fool would say no. Only a fool. But there's a price you got to pay. And it starts out very cheap. This is very, very true. As a witness, you will tell a person, do you have just 1 hour a week that you can spare to study the Bible? Just 1 hour, not two, just 1 hour. And the average person thinks, well, I got 168, 169, 170 hours. I just waste 180. I'm wasting everything. I can give God at least 1 hour. That's how it starts, man. It starts with 1 hour a week. And the next thing you know, at the end of the day, it has literally taken over your entire life. And that's how it works. And so that is how it starts. Also, people come in because they want to get into the paradise. Also, Jehovah's Witnesses have, and this is just something. I remember I had this discussion with someone before we left. Watchtower had, Jehovah's Witnesses are probably one of the coolest networks in the world. I got to admit, as a religious organization, they got one of the coolest networks in the world. Basically, any Jehovah's Witness could travel anywhere they want to travel, anywhere they want to travel in the world, pick up the phone, call the Kingdom Hall. I'm out of town, brother. I need some help in a brook down the side of the road. And basically, somebody will come by and get you. That is one of the things that is really amazing among religion. You can have two Baptist churches, one in Chicago, one in Detroit, and you couldn't call somebody from another Baptist church that don't know you and say, I'm going to be in town. That typically won't happen. But one of the things that the Jehovah's Witnesses do, they have this network, and this network works just like that. I have traveled all over. You need somewhere to stay, especially when I was at Bethel. You travel wherever you go. Where you from headquarters, brother? Come on down. My wife, she often relates experiences that she had because they was in the her dad was in the military, so they would get put on base after base. And my mother-in-law, man, she just called the local Kingdom Hall. We here, my husband on assignment, and somebody showed me the Kingdom Hall. Oh, sister, come on down, girl. We glad to have you in. Girl, come on in. We love you.
Yeah, because I didn't. When we went to Puerto Rico. We were going from Duluth. Was it? No, not Duluth. We were going from New Mexico. My dad was stationed in New Mexico, and we were moving to Puerto Rico. And I did not know this because I was little. I was young, and I didn't know what was going on. And so I couldn't understand how we had got to Puerto Rico and all these people, everybody in the Kingdom Hall was like, we're so glad to see you guys. We've been waiting for you to get here and everything. So I finally asked my mom, I said, well, how did they know we were coming? And so she said that she had told the brothers and they wrote Bethel, the headquarters, and they sent a letter to the Puerto Rican branch. And then they let them know that we were on our way to Puerto Rico. And so the brothers were there waiting on us. So when we got to Puerto Rico, we had a whole congregation, a whole lot of friends. We didn't know the language at the time because when we were in Puerto Rico, they didn't have any English-speaking congregations at the time. But the missionary couple would take us out knocking on doors right outside the gate, of the base, because they had English-speaking people outside the gate. But I just did not know that. And so, my mom, everywhere we went, she would be, knocking down the door of the Kingdom Hall. And we had people that we knew, instantly.
Yeah. But yeah. There's a catch 22 to that. There's a catch 22. The witnesses will sell this, that this is the way it is all the time. And what ends up happening is they sell you that this love that you receive, or this welcoming that you receive, everybody does that. Well, the fact of the matter is everybody doesn't. Everybody doesn't. But here's the catch. You have to pretend like it does. See, you can't tell a non-Jehovah's Witness, well, you know, some congregation, they ain't like that. They don't like people this color. They ain't got no love. You can't tell people that. So you're selling this product that there's love in every place you go. You're going to be welcome. And that's not true. It's not true. But the problem is you can't really tell nobody about that part. So you have the witness religion literally selling this product that everywhere you go, this is what it's going to be like.
Well, you know what? See, here's the thing about that. And this is what I learned through my own personal experience. The reason why our family was so well liked is because my mom was out in field service knocking on doors. And she was a very, very regular out. And she was a very active Jehovah's Witness. And so she hung out with a lot of the like elders, wives and pioneers and stuff like that. So that's the reason why, you know, she did so well. But we have been in congregations with people who hit and miss going to the Kingdom Hall, didn't go to the meetings, and they would be called spiritually weak and stuff like that. And so they didn't get that support. But my mom, she was out because my mom didn't work a job. So working for the Watchtower, that was her job. She didn't get paid, but, you know, she was working, you know.
Love
so it is, you know. That was my personal experience.
This is great. And yeah, Mormons have this global community and network too. Wherever you go, you can find Mormons that will welcome you and treat you like a brother or sister. So we really relate to that.
Oh, absolutely.
Let me ask you this. What is it? I'm of the belief that religions thrive because they actually do add value, at least for a time and at least for a certain group of people. What are the aspects of the Jehovah's Witness life that actually are in many ways healthy or valuable that's allowed the Jehovah's Witness, you know, church to thrive? There's got to be good. What are the aspects that are good or viewed as valuable to the members? What would you say those things are?
Oh, I think it's the association. I think it's the lifestyle.
What do you mean? The
value of, you know, like they don't smoke or you know, to get drunk. They don't, you know, different stuff like that. And you have
name all those things because Mormons don't drink. What else? Don't drink. Don't smoke. What else?
They do drink, but they're not allowed to get drunk.
Okay, no getting drunk.
When we were in the Jehovah's Witness religion, you didn't worry about people coming to your house stealing. You could trust people. It was just one of those things where you knew that the life was wholesome. You didn't have to worry about people going out to clubs and, you know, getting in trouble or, you know, like dating your wife. Maybe you go to the Kingdom Hall and some brother's trying to hit on some sister and it's not his wife and stuff like that. This kind of stuff happens. You know, people have, you know, they get in trouble, but you just felt like the association was clean.
That's overall. Good, clean living.
And you know what? We got a lot of people that we know that left or they won't leave because of that. Because they're like, where are we going to go? Who are we going to hang out with? Who y'all hanging out with? You know? And so, and because Jehovah's Witnesses, they don't really get that many invites. If you have a party, you ain't got to worry about nobody not showing up. You know? It's like, you know, like some people, they like some of the things that they would teach us in the congregation, the Kingdom Hall, it would be like, if you get an invitation, don't you know, take an invitation and then, you know, get a better invitation and then go over here. So, you know, people kind of stuck. They kept their word pretty much, kind of stuff like that.
And they support each other. They try and support each other.
Yeah, they try to support each other. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's a very good point. For me, since I have left the organization, I have sat back and I have asked the question as well. And my philosophical viewpoint is that religious belief systems, they serve a very valuable role. I think that anyone who says that they don't is not really looking at what religious belief systems actually do. Religious belief systems, they provide us as humans with answers to life's most difficult questions. Why are we here? Where are we going? What happens after death? That's what religious belief systems do. They will provide us with one, comforting, and two, satisfying answers to life's most difficult questions. Now, with that having been said, that don't mean the answer's right, but they will provide you with comforting and satisfying answers. And what people do is we seek out the religious belief system that provides us with that comforting and satisfying answer. And typically when people find that religious belief system, an announcement will be made. I have found the truth. I found the truth. And then sometimes something else starts. And this is kind of interesting. The religious belief system that this person now has, they will now turn to you and say, Bob, you need to have the same religious belief system I have. Because if you don't, my God is going to kill you. And you will see this system. You will literally see this as you look through religious belief system. After the person feels, well, this is what I need, then this is what you need. And if you don't accept what I got, you got to die. And so religious belief systems, they will answer those questions. I mean, you look anywhere around the world. I mean, literally anywhere around the world, people will find those. But it doesn't necessarily mean that the answers is right. It doesn't mean the answers are true. But they do satisfy that person. And so we often talk about this. Without religious belief system keeping people in check, over the years, you know, religious belief system will tell you, you know, you're gonna be punished if you do something wrong. That, I mean, punishment is always a component. You can get punished. And so as kids, we know we didn't do a lot of stuff because our parents would punish us. Well, religious belief system have a component where it says you're gonna get punished. And so it actually keep people, you know, in line. I mean, as a society and stuff. It's the sad part is that too many times religious belief systems, they will take over the person's entire life. Because basically you have high control groups and you have low control groups. And you can talk to people, well, you have one religion where they impact everything you do. There's an article that the Watchtower wrote just to show you just how this thing works. Where Jehovah's Witnesses were writing to the Watchtower Bible and Tract Society, can I buy my child this toy? So you have a group of adults who are part of a religious belief system, 35, 45, 50 years old, they're at the point where they don't even know if they can buy their child a toy because they need somebody. And as the Watchtower said, some friends need somebody to make a ruling. But that's because the Watchtower makes its members so dependent. When I was an elder, the number one question I got as an elder, can we do that? Is it okay? Because the witness doesn't know what he can and cannot do. He doesn't know. And so as a result, when you have to ask somebody what you can and cannot do, you can rest assured, man, somebody's going to be willing to tell you what you can and cannot do. And that's kind of how it works in the organization. And that's what leads people down all kinds of roads to bad decisions. And it just goes downhill.
Well, see, it really... were you going to ask a question?
No. Go ahead.
Well, I was going to say, really, it goes when the religion first started. You know, the rules weren't there. And so the least number of people that you have part of the group, you know, you don't have to, you know, bring the reins in so tight. Because, you know, at one point, I don't know if people knew this, but Jehovah's Witnesses used to celebrate Christmas years ago. And then as things started changing, they want to be different, more different from other religions. I don't know why they changed. But anyway, bottom line is, you know, like when he was at Bethel, he would talk about, which is the world headquarters for people who are just joining of Jehovah's Witnesses. Basically, if something happened with those 6,000 brothers at Bethel, like they had a what was that? They had the thing about the practical jokes. They had something about practical jokes, you know, because that they wrote in the Watchtower because a Bethelite did a practical joke on somebody and made them think that somebody had fallen off the roof, you know. So when little things like that happen, or they had these people that were having parties at these big hotels, charging people to get in. And they had thousands of young people that were at these parties, and it was getting out of control. So they started writing articles about not having large gatherings. So, you know, as the witnesses grew and people began to do things that was going to make the group look bad, the Watchtower Society was like saying, no, you can't do that. And so there were things that are not even biblical that you can't do, all because they can't control the number of people that are participating in these activities.
Interesting. Yeah, I really relate to that. Like, somehow in Mormonism, Orthodox Mormons believe that God never changes, the church never changes, the church is the same now, all the way back to Jesus. It's basically the Mormon church is the same as Jesus's church. I'm exaggerating, but that's kind of, there's this mindset.
I know. Same here. We believe the same.
There's this mindset that the church never changes, God never changes, but the church changes all the time, but somehow... They know how to change just slowly enough, just gradually enough, and just in the delicate ways so that members don't realize that 50 years ago was a totally different church than, you know, in many ways than the church is now. You guys relate to that?
Absolutely. Yep. Absolutely. I mean, if you look at the witnesses of the turn of the century, you would not recognize them. And in fact, for those of us who have left coming out of the 70s, 80s, and 90s, when we look at this organization, we do not recognize it. Let me just give you one simple example. When I was at the world headquarters, one of the things that the governing body was always cognizant of, and that is they kept a very low profile. The average Jehovah's Witness around the world had never even seen the governing body. If you were to ask them, can you name the members of the governing body? You would not be able to name them, because these guys, they stayed in the background, which is what they liked, because they didn't want to be the face. They didn't want to be on the front line. The new governing body, man, these boys are rock stars. These are rock stars. And I'll give you a perfect example of what a rock star is like. A member of the governing body was attending a summer convention, and someone had written to us and said, you will not believe what I saw happening. There was a line of people standing in front of this governing body member for the purpose of him autographing their Bible. How do you autograph a book that don't even belong to you? I thought it was God's book. How are you going to sign somebody's name up there on somebody's book? And so these guys are like rock stars. Mm-hmm. And so for a lot of witnesses who came up in that era, they're like, this is you're overshadowing Jesus Christ right now. Mm-hmm. And so it causes them to take that pause. We tell people to do, take that pause, take a step back and start asking some serious questions. And so for a lot of people, they just look at how the leadership runs things now. And it is really causing a lot of people to just take pause just on that alone.
Yeah. I'm hearing a tiny bit of an echo. Is there something that happened on your end that made my voice have an echo? Did your microphone go up? Can you? Okay. Now I don't hear it anymore. Okay. I don't hear it anymore.
Okay.
Something just changed. Okay. Okay. This is great. Okay. So let's talk. You talked about no birthdays. You talked about no Christmas, no holidays. What are the main, you know, with Mormonism, it's a certain set of behaviors. What are the biggest, most important behaviors that sort of stand out for a Jehovah's Witness that are different maybe than other religious traditions? What behaviors define a faithful Jehovah's Witness?
Wow, that's a good question. Probably the biggest thing that defines a Jehovah's Witness is their acceptance of what they're told, published in the Watchtower magazines.
Mm.
I know people who they go to church and they'll disagree with their pastor. I don't know what he was talking about today. It didn't make no sense. Jehovah's Witness would never do that. Not publicly anyway.
Mm.
A Jehovah's Witness is taught to view the published works that you find in the Watchtower publications as food from God. Manna. There is an experience that the Watchtower wrote. The Watchtower uses experiences of witnesses as teaching tools. In other words, if we want you to do something, we're going to give you an example of what we really want you to do without telling you. Hence, you can't claim that we told you to do this. The writing department, man, has the coolest writing style in the world. They can write stuff without saying it. And it's like one guy said, they can cut you and you don't even know who cut you. And your shirt is turning red. You don't even know when you got cut. And that's what the Watchtower can do. There was an article about a witness. The article dealt with witnesses who were questioning the Watchtower Society. And they gave the example of an older couple that went down to their mailbox. This is when they used to send out the magazine in subscription form. You get them in your mailbox. They went out to get the mail. They came back in. And the circuit overseer, or another witness, was staying with them. And the older couple said, now, before we have breakfast, we want to thank Jehovah for this magazine before we take this wrap off. So will you mind praying with us? Because we're going to offer up a prayer for this magazine that we just got from the United States, New York City. And so you're talking about idolatry? I mean, my goodness. And so this is what they did. They got down on their knees and they prayed to God to thank him for this Watchtower magazine that probably in about 5 or 6 years was going to end up in the trash because so much information was now wrong or outdated. Mm-hmm. And so this is the type of mindset that as a witness, and now this particular example, when witnesses around the world read this, this lets them know this is what your view toward these publications should be, just like this guy here that we use in this magazine. And that is one of the most powerful teaching things that witnesses use. They use examples of other people. And they say, this right here, this is a good Christian. This is a good servant of Jehovah. Why aren't you doing that? And the guilt tripping that takes place because of that, man, it is unreal. It is just unreal.
And I think the other thing, and I know other religions, because I've talked to people and they've talked about how Jehovah's Witnesses are not the only people that shun.
Oh, yeah.
And so, but I think to the greater good or the greater bad, pretty much, I don't know if these other religions shun the way Jehovah's Witnesses shun.
Yeah.
Because we know people that have never spoken to their grandkids. Or this one family that I know out in Iowa, I kind of adopted them because their grandparents won't have anything to do with them. And one of the little kids who's now like 10 years old doesn't even know that she has grandparents. Mm-hmm. That's how long it's been. So basically, when you look at the way they do the shunning, I mean, when I say shunning, I mean, my dad called my uncle, who is not a Jehovah's Witness, who's the husband of the aunt that shunned me to the day she died. When my dad called the house to talk to her husband, because her husband's not a witness, but she got to the point where the husband couldn't talk to us and he wasn't a witness. And so whenever my dad would call the house, she wouldn't talk to my dad. She would just hand the phone straight to her husband. But then it got so bad that my uncle would have to sneak out the house, or he would be at the hospital with my aunt in the parking lot calling my dad to see how my dad is doing, because he can't talk to my dad in front of his wife. And he ain't even a Jehovah's Witness. So she got him shunning or sneaking around a corner to call somebody. It's terrible.
Yeah. Get that beat down, man. Get that beat down.
So that's shunning. And that's all about following the Watchtower, too, because you know, there's people like my dad was raised as a Catholic. My grandmother was going to be a nun. She was in a convent for 9 years. And for some reason, she never got, you know, became a nun. But, you know, I understood that they don't let you take communion if you're not in good standing, but they ain't shunning you, you know. So they didn't get. I mean, my aunt couldn't take communion because, you know, she wasn't going to church. So when they got ready to go do communion at my grandmother's funeral, they wouldn't let her come up there and take her communion or nothing like that. But nobody was shunning her at the church because she wasn't going to church. So Jehovah's Witnesses, if you don't go to church, if you don't go to the Kingdom Hall, you're going to be shunned.
Mm.
That's a big one. That's a huge one.
Wow. You know, that's just so, what I just heard is profound. First of all, Mormons shun, and there is hard shunning within Mormonism, but what's more common is this soft shunning, where you're not invited to things, you're viewed as a disappointment by your friends and family. Maybe they won't let their kids play with your kids. you know, there's more soft shunning than hard shunning, although hard shunning exists. And that is one of the main things I expected to hear from you. Of course, I expected, you know, no blood transfusions, no pledge of allegiance, no birthdays, no Christmas. And of course, the missionary work is something that sets both Mormons and Jehovah's Witnesses apart. But I almost got chills when JT, you jumped right to what I think is probably the dominant rule within both the Mormon Church and in the Jehovah's Witness Church. And it was also reflected by a comment by ex-Jehovah's Witness Activism New Zealand. They wrote, loyalty and obedience to the faithful and discreet slave is the number one rule of the Jehovah's Witnesses. And my dear friend Amy Germer from Seattle wrote, Mormons don't question their prophets. So obedience to authority, I think, is the number one doctrine of both our churches. Is that fair to say?
Oh, there's no question about it. This is why I often get Jehovah's Witnesses in a conversation. Witnesses will make the following statement when you talk about their doctrines are changing. And they'll say, well, our core doctrines have never changed. And you'll say, well, what are your core doctrines? They always, you know, the hell, fire, and all this kind of stuff. And then I'll say, well, let me ask you a question. Because I noticed the list that you gave me of all of your core doctrines that have not changed. Why did you leave off the doctrine of the faithful and discreet slave? Is that not one of your core doctrines? And I had this debate with witnesses, and you will see, for some of them, they will stop and they were like, yeah, that really is. Because that is, as someone mentioned in the comment, that is basically the foundational teaching of everything about Jehovah's Witnesses.
Tell us what that is. What is that teaching?
The Watchtower is basically very similar to the Catholic Church, apostolic succession. You know, we got the Pope today is supposed to go all the way back to Peter. That's kind of the way the Catholic Church works. Well, the witnesses have their own process of getting back to the apostles. And they do it by what they call the governing body or the faithful and discreet slave. So the 12 apostles, they started it off, and then they included everybody who got baptized. And this is where the witnesses made a crucial mistake in their teachings. I mean, it is a serious mistake in teaching, especially when you start telling people the teaching is from God. When the witnesses started out, and we did a video on this, and we invite people to, it's the 144,000 video. The witnesses started out teaching that every person who was baptized was of the anointed and going to heaven. Now, when you go all the way back to Christianity, back with Jesus, and they were counting all the way back to Jesus' day, which means from 33 CE all the way till the early 1900s, there had not been 144,000 people who had served Christ. Because remember, the teaching was every person who dips into the water, comes up out, is of the anointed. And how many of the anointed? 144,000. Very quickly, the Watchtower realized a very simple fact. We got more people than we got seats.
Yeah, because they believe that the 144,000 is literal.
That's exactly literal right. Number. So what did the Watchtower have to do? They had to change their teachings. And what did they do? They literally created a second tier set of Christians called the Great Crowd. Because they was up like 54,000 people. Where are the anointed? You only got 144,000 slots. So it wasn't anybody who does trajectory knows if we keep moving at this rate, we're going to hit 144,000 real soon and we'll have no more seats. And so that's why they had to change the teaching. They had to literally change the teaching. And as a result, they now had to create an entire new theology. And today, when we were witnesses, we were taught as kids, one of the signs that you know the world is about to end soon is that the number of those who are of the anointed will decrease. Every year. Oh, yeah. Every year, man. And for any Jehovah's Witness who is watching this video, who's been around this religion for a number of years, they know what I am saying is true. We have a book, it's called the Yearbook. It gives the count of how many are of the anointed. Every year when it was released, witnesses would open the book and they would find that page. And when they find the page and the number was decreasing, it was a confirmation. Man, the system's about to wrap up. It's about to wrap up, man. It's about to wrap up. When we left, when my wife and I left, there was about 7,000. And as a kid, it went down like 14,000, 12,000 until I became an adult. And when we left, it was like down to 7,000.
Mm.
Man, it's 20,000 people now. Numbers going back up. They must have set some new folding chairs up in there. I don't know. But this is what happens when you have teachings that you make up. And the Watchtower has actually acknowledged that a lot of their teachings, man, they just made up. Like I said, the guy called Fred Franz, he was literally the master behind the teachings of Jehovah's Witnesses. Some of their most prolific and most confusing and deep teachings was just stuff he made up. He just made it up. I'm serious. Fred Franz just made it up. He made it up. How do we know? Very simple. It's in the trash now. It don't take rocket science. If you have a teaching of God that's sitting over in the trash can, that means the guy made it up. That's all it means. The guy made it up. And yeah. So most of all those deep teachings about the Gentile times and mm-hmm. the antitype and the types, all that trash is in the trash.
Mm-hmm.
I tell my wife, and I often tell people all the time, when I was a kid, my sister, even at her age, she realized it was goofy. We would be studying the Watchtower lesson, and it would be about the antitype this and the antitype that. And my sister would say, Mama, this don't make no sense. And then we would get to the Kingdom Hall, and they would have the Watchtower study. And during the Watchtower study, people raise their hand, and they comment on the paragraphs in the Watchtower. On those deep lessons, you might have maybe three, maybe four, maybe five people who basically carried the whole meeting. 125 people sitting like, I don't really know what, I'm not sure about that. So you have like maybe the elders, a couple of pioneer sisters, they would literally carry the whole meeting. And then the Watchtower conductor would conclude by saying, now brothers, today's lesson was solid food, steak. This wasn't no milk, it was steak. You got to chew on it for a little while. And so you're sitting there in the audience, man, feeling like an idiot because you're like, man, I just didn't understand this deep stuff. God was trying to help us understand it. I'm spiritually weak because I couldn't grasp the point. And that's how everybody felt. Only to find out 25 years later, man, all this stuff was trash. And so this is the type of stuff that people are now able to see and able to talk about. Because even though you may have thought that the meetings or something was goofy and it was just made no sense, you couldn't tell nobody. You couldn't talk to nobody about it. But then the internet came along. And now people grow up there very anonymously. Did you see that lesson today? What do you think of that paragraph 14? That was some crazy stuff. Well, sure was. It was stupid. Now they can do it.
You know what? I remember like during the time that I was meeting more Jehovah's Witnesses that were my age, I was meeting my husband. I was doing some deep research of my own, but it wasn't really research because you can't really research using somebody else's book. You gotta research people that's talking about them, not reading their own books, but their own books was telling some stories about them. And I remember reading this one book. I can't even remember the name of the book, but I remember reading Millions Now Living Will Never Die. And so I'm sitting there thinking, I'm way younger than I am now, right? And I'm thinking, that don't make no sense. These people are already dead. Because the Millions Now Living was like back in the early 1900s. And I'm reading this in the late 80s. But what's happening to me is I am getting more sucked in through my associates because I'm meeting people that, you know, have a lot in common with me, and we were connecting. And you're, because before, you know, I had met these other Jehovah's Witnesses, you know, I'm living in this little small town, ain't no witnesses my age, everybody's older than me, you know, you believe this is the truth, so you think that this is where you gotta be. And so you're starting to finally meet people your age in the truth, in the Watchtower, so-called truth. And then I always tell people I was a mail order bride because there was this sister in my congregation. she had knew JT and his roommate, and they were getting ready to come down to the district convention that year. And she goes, I got these brothers coming to visit, and they're coming down from New York. And she goes, and JT will just love you, you know? And so I'm like, oh God. And so I had already been, almost got hitched with this other brother that, I don't even want to go into that detail right now. But, I was like, I don't want to meet no brothers. I don't care who's coming, whatever. And, then I did, when I finally met JT, you know, I thought JT's kind of cute. JT's kind of cute, right? So, but I mean, you know, so we knew each other for 3 years before we got married. But see how that sucked me in? Here's this man who's coming down from Bethel. He's coming from the Harvard and Yale, as he would say.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he's all into this religion.
Mm-hmm.
And he is the one that really got me in deep to this religion.
Mm.
Because even though my mother was, you know, a what I would consider a devout Jehovah's Witness, well, you know, she was out in field service at all her meetings, he took it a step further, because he was like turning people in for little mild infractions. She watching soap operas, we gonna turn her into her brothers, you know. It's like, I ain't never heard that before, you know, somebody watching The Young and the Restless, and now you're gonna get turned into the elders because you watching Jack and Ashley and all them. You know, but I'm just saying, it's like, what is going on? So he sucks me further in. He got me, you know, like looking at people at the corner of my eye, at my eye, like you can't be around them. Cause see, witnesses are particular in the group. So it's not just you're a Jehovah's Witness and you're at the meetings, but if you're going to the Kingdom Hall and you're, you know, like doing questionable things, you could be a Jehovah's Witness and people will be shunning you. Like you said, soft shunning, mm-hmm. because they ain't doing everything they're supposed to be doing with Watchtower. So he comes down from Bethel and it's a whole nother ball of wax. It's mm-hmm. like I'm being introduced to a whole new facet of this religion that I didn't grow up with. Because my mother, she didn't like tell me to get baptized as a Jehovah's Witness. She didn't tell me that Jehovah was going to destroy me at Armageddon if I didn't get baptized. I heard that from the platform at the Kingdom Hall.
Mm-hmm.
And what sold me was my father and I took a road trip. We were going from Michigan to Maryland. On our way back, the car breaks down. And we were like 50 miles from our house. I was 16 years old. Never forget this. And my mother was trying to call everybody in her family. That, you know, me and my dad, we stuck on the side of the road. And this is pre-cell phone, okay? And I was scared to death. I'm shaking like a leaf. There's these guys that, there were some guys that stopped and said, my dad asked them where the nearest gas station was. And they said it was over this way. And my dad didn't trust them, so he went over that way. And we just kind of like barely made it into the gas station parking lot. And so I told my dad, so when we finally get into the gas, and you know how your mind kind of just runs with you. And now that we travel, we find out that, you know, there's really a gas station on both sides of the road. At the time, you're thinking these guys were steering us over here because they were going to come back and rob us and all this kind of stuff. So every time the little diner opened, because we ended up getting to a gas station, but there was a little diner that was actually attached to this gas station. And so we were in there, and every time that door opened, I'm like, they're coming back for us. They're going to come back and get us. They realize we didn't go to the right place that they told us to go to, and they're coming back for us. And I'm sitting there just shaking like a leaf. So what ends up happening is my mom, she finally gets in touch with the brothers at the Kingdom Hall, right? Not her worldly family, not her non-Jehovah's Witness family, who had their whole Saturday planned. They're going fishing, boating, going to the beach, but they weren't coming to pick us up. We couldn't get them to come and get us, right? So this is the brothers in the Kingdom Hall. Brother Elder comes to pick us up. And it was like John Wayne and the Calvary had arrived. And at that point, I was like, this is the truth. We couldn't get them worldly relatives of ours to come and get us, but these Jehovah's Witnesses, they were here and picking us up and didn't even complain. didn't charge us no money. And I was like, this is the truth. I said, when I get old enough, because I didn't get baptized until I was 18, so a couple years, but I was sold. I said, this is the truth, because those brothers were there for us. And I had a lot of, you know, we saw a lot of these different things happening in our lives that said that this was the truth. And that was my selling point. And that's what I thought.
Yeah. I love it.
Yes, that's very profound. A personal experience like that. And what's so interesting is what my wife described, this overshadows teachings, doctrines. I've lived this. I've seen it. I've experienced it. And so that's all you need. And so the emotional part will say, I don't care about the doctrines. And there are lots of people right now that we know, they don't care about the doctrine. I mean, we have people who right now will tell us, I don't care about the doctrines. I like being here. And so I'm thinking about, and you're like, well, we tell people when we knock on doors that if you're going to stay in your church, you got to stay in your church because the doctrines are right. Well, that's different for us. Like, no, how can it be different for us? We tell people we're not going to door and say, if your church is not teaching what the Bible said, we need to think about leaving. And then you sit and saying that you don't even care about the doctrines anymore. So you see that social aspect of it? That's kind of what it was kind of what is different for my wife and I. Her background or her experience and things that helped her to leave dealt more with the human aspect of people. For myself, it was strictly doctrines.
Yeah.
It was strictly doctrines and the corporate side, because I saw this organization from the corporate side.
Right.
And like we tell people all the time, one of the things I noticed in this organization, the people who move up the ladder in this organization, and it just, this don't make no sense. It shouldn't be that way. The people who move up, they are typically individuals who are less at demonstrating the fruits of God's spirit, love, kindness, selfishness. Not these guys, but they are very corporate men. We used to call them society men, Watchtower society men, corporate. And those are the ones who actually move up to be referred. When I was at headquarters, if you refer to as he's a good society man, he's a good society man, that means you're a good company man. That's what that means. You're a good company man, which means you will do only what you are told. And that was how I was groomed. I have a mentor, and that was how I was groomed. You only go with what is in print. If the society, if the slave has not said it, don't do it. And so that was how I lived my life. And when I moved, and like she was talking about turning my mother-in-law in because she was watching the story. That the Watchtower has an article that deals with, it's entitled "Do Not Share in the Sins of Others." And this particular article is used by elders and circuit overseers to give what is called a service talk. If they're having some problems in the congregation, you will put together a talk based on "Do not share in the sins of others." And I remember circuit said, told, he said, I need everybody here to make sure this one elder has this talk in his bag. So when you need to give it, you already got it ready to go. And the reason why this particular article, "Do not share in the sins of others," is one of the most powerful articles to get people to turn in and rat on their friends, their wife, their cousin, their brother, their mama. In fact, to turn yourself in. And so witnesses will actually turn each other in. Husbands will turn wives in. Wives will turn her. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Brothers, I'm concerned about my husband. He's starting to question what the society says in the magazine. Sister, you did the right thing. We'll talk to him, sister. And so,
yeah, we get emails from people all the time, man, where, you know, they're no longer with their spouse.
Yeah.
They're getting into divorce because they don't want to belong to this religion.
Man, that is probably the worst. Oh,
yeah.
That is the worst, man. I mean, my wife, she will talk to people. I will talk to people. And when we compare the conversations, it's always the same. Their spouse was questioning the organization, questioning the faithful in the streets. And we're talking about it's one thing if it's a man and, you know, he got a job and he can take care of himself. But, man, there'll be women who don't even work. They have no income. I'm still leaving. Like, well, you ain't got no money, girl. Where you going? And so it doesn't matter because they view this as a test of their faith and their loyalty. Everything in this organization, every single thing in this organization, man, is typically couched or put in the context of this is a test of your loyalty to God. And if everything that happens is always viewed in that vein, your job. Your job says you got to work tonight. You got a meeting tonight. This is your test, brother. Are you going to pass the test? I mean, so it's like, well, suppose if I don't go to work, I lose my job. Well, once again, that's another test. Can you? It's like we're just being tested all day long. Mm-hmm. And so it gets ridiculous after a while.
So what happens in a Jehovah's Witness marriage if one loses their faith? Is divorce allowed? Is divorce encouraged? Is divorce discouraged? Can changes in faith break up a Jehovah's Witness family? And if so, how?
You want to tell him? Want to talk about this?
Well, he told me if I would have left the organization, he would have left me. He wasn't going to stay. Mm-hmm. You know? And he told me that if I wanted to keep going to the kingdom, after he found out this wasn't the truth, you know, he told me if I wanted to keep going to the meetings and stuff, I could have kept going. But he said that we probably wouldn't have lasted because he knew he wasn't going. And, you know, if I'm still going to be looking at him and saying, you need to be at the meetings, you need to be out in service, and you go into the meetings and people remember when he was an elder at Bethel, you know, that's going to really wear your relationship down. Mm-hmm. Because this religion is really all about, I mean, you wear this religion on your sleeve. This is not like I go to church on Sunday and I can do what I want Monday through Saturday. This is, I'm waking up a Jehovah's Witness. I'm doing my daily text. I'm, you know, making sure I'm studying for these meetings. I'm at these meetings. I'm out in service. I'm telling people in January that I'm getting ready for the district convention in June. Because, I mean, this is all you're doing. This is it. A Jehovah's Witness, the first thing you do, you call somebody on the phone, and you live in California and they live in New York City. And the first thing they're talking about, who's your circuit overseer? What did you get that point at the meeting that they had last week? Every conversation is built around the religion to the point where people are going to know that you are not keeping up just by your responses. Mm-hmm. And one sister told me she moved from California to Boston, and there's this one YouTube channel that she keeps track of because she wants to keep in touch with her family in California. And so by her listening to this other YouTube channel, they keep up with all the latest updates. And so she said that she's able to continue having conversations with her family, making them think that she's still going because she's able to get this information off the internet. So you're not going to get away from, you know, these Jehovah's Witnesses and be able to be around them without them realizing that you're not participating. And I'll give you a perfect example. Jehovah's Witnesses are very into these titles. And when we left, the head elder at the Kingdom Hall was known as the presiding overseer. And, you know, some years ago, they changed it to the COBE, the coordinating body of elders. And so now if we keep talking about the PO, you know, presiding overseer, then Jehovah's Witnesses are going to be like, you ain't up to date. You know, you're not up to date with the latest teachings. And I remember when I was, you know, coming along, and we used to have this green Bible. And so it would be so funny because you would see somebody come to the meeting and they'd be visiting. And then we don't went to the black Bibles, you know. And then with JT at Bethel, they would get your name printed on the Bible. And then they had different types of black Bibles. They had like the soft cover black Bible. And then they had that like hard cover black Bible. But when that brother or sister came to the meeting with that green Bible, you were like, they Jehovah's Witnesses from the 60s. You know, because we ain't had, you know, green Bibles in years. And so you would know, you know, that they ain't up with the times, you know. So it's just all kind of stuff like that, you know.
Yeah. They focus your mind. If you're with a group of Jehovah's Witnesses, and let's say you're talking about sports or whatever, witnesses are taught. Now, all of them don't do it. But this is the point. It's the culture. They teach you to redirect the conversation. Redirect the conversation to talk about something that you heard at the Kingdom Hall, something you read in the magazine. And so this is how you, and this is why we're telling people it's important to understand the culture, because see, you, if there are four of you and you want to talk about, you know, man, you know, I tell you, man, the Washington Redskins, they need to change that name and whatever. And all of a sudden they're like, well, you know, there was an interesting article in the Watchtower last week. And you're trying to go back to the game. They will quickly realize he ain't spiritual. He ain't spiritual. He ain't spiritual at all. And so now all of a sudden they will begin to distance from you. Mm-hmm. And so these are like culture. You will never find this written in the magazine, but this is how the culture works. And every witness watching this knows. If a witness, in fact, if a witness get caught watching this show right here, as an elder, it would be my responsibility to pull that person to the side and say, you know, brother, I understand you was watching some former witnesses on the internet. What does the society, what does the Watchtower say about that? And so he in trouble. Yeah. And so witnesses, sometimes we look at our stats and we see there's so many people who come, but they cannot subscribe. They cannot subscribe. Can you imagine mm-hmm. you with some witnesses and you subscribe to JT and Lady C and all of a sudden that thing says ding and this pops up and, oh Lord and so they can't do it.
There's so much fear.
One sister said, she said, I was watching y'all channel for a long time before I felt like I could subscribe because she was afraid of what you were saying. She thought other people would be able to see her subscription, who she was subscribed to.
Yeah.
And so she was like, I am not subscribing to that channel.
It's crazy.
But you know,
as soon as I got excommunicated, people wouldn't like my Facebook posts. They wouldn't like it. They wouldn't want to friend me. Because they were just terrified what would happen if anybody saw that someone liked or friended me on Facebook. And we've got the same thing. So in a mixed faith, we call it mixed faith marriages. So, you know, would you shun? Let's just say you're married, your husband loses his faith. I mean, if somebody leaves the church, the Jehovah's Witness Church, I'm guessing they might get shunned. In Scientology, it's called a suppressive person. In the Mormonism, it's called an apostate. Would a wife shun the husband if the husband lost his faith? How would that work? Could it break up a family ultimately? It sounds like you're saying it could and it does.
Well, remember what happened? Okay, there was this one couple that was in our congregation. And we had a busybody sister in our congregation. Now, the way it's supposed to work is this. You can still talk to your spouse, but you're not supposed to talk about spiritual things. So this one sister came up to us at the circuit assembly. She was like a busybody. And she goes, I need to talk to Brother JT. I got to talk to Brother. And so she, come here. I saw Sister So-and-so talking to her husband. And she was during the assembly. She's talking to her husband. So then JT looked at her and said, do you know what they were talking about? She says, no, but they ain't supposed to be. And, you know, so she was going off about how she wasn't supposed to be talking to her husband about, you know, she thought they were talking about the assembly. And so that's the way it's supposed to work. They're not supposed to be shunning or treating them bad or nothing like that. But they're not supposed to talk about spiritual things. So if it's a man, he's not supposed to be leading his wife, you know, with spirituality in the home. That's how it's supposed to.
And that's kind of interesting because if for the believer, the Jehovah's Witness religion is the most important thing in their life, and then they can't talk to their spouse about the most important thing in their life, what does that do in the marriage to their emotional intimacy if they just have to live separate lives that way in terms of their interests and their passions? That can't be good, right?
Oh, it's absolutely terrible. In fact, we know people who are actually living that right now as we talk. I mean, we literally know so many people. They contact us, they call us, they cry. It's tough. Let me just give you some of the parameters, which is kind of from the organization side. If a person's spouse is disfellowship, let's go with the man is disfellowship and the wife is still a witness. Because typically, remember, the man is the head of the household. So he has to pray for the dinner and all this kind of stuff. Well, he can't pray no more. Because she can't be bowing her head. And most women, they know that. Okay. So one of the things that happens is it depends on the Watchtower says, depends on what his attitude is, though. Depends on what his attitude is. Some people, they get this fellowship because maybe they did something wrong or whatever. But then you have people who get this fellowship because they've been questioning the organization. And as you mentioned before, this person is called an apostate. The Watchtower teaches, and this is why we tell people who are starting to, this is why we tell people, especially men or women, if you are married, and it's a very sad thing to have to say, man, but we only say it because of what we have seen. What we see and what we know can happen, and it does happen. You need to be prepared for the possibility that your spouse may leave you. You need to be prepared. And here is the reason why. The same way you're on the phone with us talking to us, or we're out dinner talking about your family and your wife, you know, she's still in and you can't get her out. Your wife is talking to the elders. She's talking to the elders. And the elders are telling her the following, based on the official teachings of the Watchtower. Sister, if you feel that you are in experiencing a situation where you are in spiritual endangerment, you are being, your spirituality is at danger. If you believe that, sister, you can leave this man.
There it is.
And so the congregation is going to support her for leaving this apostate agent of Satan, first cousin of Satan. I mean, and so this is what we tell people, and this is really the catcher. And this is what makes the internet so important today. People who are leaving, they need to understand the dynamics. Some people just jump up and make the announcement, this ain't the truth. And it's true. But they're not prepared for the backlash. And man, believe me, the backlash is fast and furious. I mean, like you mentioned about people unliking you. We had someone that was this fellowship. They had over 1,200 people. 24 hours, man, over 800 people. Unlike, because word spread. He's his fellowship. Get off his site. And witnesses know what to do. So if it's a family, if it's a couple, and this is what destroys families in this religion. And unfortunately, and it's really a kicker, if a woman or a husband, spouse is this fellowship, what is supposed to happen, but rarely does. The congregation is supposed to rally around the sister and her kids who are still going to the meetings. Mm-hmm. Typically, that's not what happens. Mm. What happens is they're like, you know what? We don't want them over. We ain't having them. But don't invite them over here. We don't know what's going on over there. And so this sister who's trying her best to be faithful, dragging her little four kids to the kingdom hall, ain't getting no love, ain't being invited to no functions, ain't being together nowhere. And so it just has a cascading effect on people. All of a sudden, that love that you were promised for so many people. And I know kids, it's worse as a kid because you get left out. I mean, we got left out. My mom didn't. My dad was not a witness. And my mom had four kids. And so a lot of times, man, we would go to the kingdom hall on Sunday, man, and the other kids go, JT, why weren't y'all at the cookout? Why weren't y'all at the cookout? Like, what cookout are you talking about? You found out you didn't get invited. You weren't part of the clique. You weren't part of the circle. No, and kids don't know that. You know, you're 8, 9 years old. You went to the cookout over at Brother Johnson's house and y'all had a good time. You look around, where's JT? He ain't here. And so they see you at the meeting and they ask you about it. And then you're like, well, I ain't know anything about it. And so you just got left behind.
And you know, that's really sad too, because as they're telling you not to hang out with your worldly relatives that would love to have you at their place. You know, they don't want to invite you to their cookouts. And we had this one circuit overseer that gave a talk, and it was called Widen Out in Your Love. And he said, you got these people, you're out in service, you knock on the door, you tell them to come to the meeting, they come to the kingdom hall, you get them to slowly stop hanging out with their friends. And then next thing you know, you're not inviting them to any of your cookouts or your get-togethers. So you got them to give up their whole life, but then you're not even inviting them or making them feel like they're part of the congregation. And so, you know, they give those little talks, but they don't really stick around long. I mean, people start inviting people, then over a period of time, they go back to their little cliques and stuff, you know?
3 months later, they don't stop, you know, so.
Yeah, I think I heard you say in one of your episodes that the community can feel like a community of love until somebody stops doing what they're supposed to be doing. And all of a sudden, the community becomes really thin and unreliable. Is that true? Kind of superficial relationships that are tenuous, they don't last if people fall out of line?
Yeah, we call that conditional love. Mm-hmm. It's conditional. And the condition is you're supposed to be doing what the Watchtower magazines and books say you're supposed to be doing. And this cuts, and that's why we tell people all the time, don't buy that lie, please. Don't buy that lie that blood is thicker than water. As any ex-Jehovah's Witness, as any person who is an ex in cults and high control groups, the best definition or the best explanation somebody I heard say, and when the guy said, I said, man, that is, you are on the money. If you want to know if you're in a cult or a high control group, observe how they treat you when you leave. That's how you know. We have people we work with, family we have. They change church. I'm gonna be Episcopalian this week. I'm going out to the Baptist church. Their family, their friends don't change. But in the organizations that are high control groups and cults, you watch how they treat you when you leave. That is your flag. If you want to know if you're in a high control group, watch how they treat you when you leave, and they will treat you. I remember talks, man. This is the definition. I remember a circuit officer gave this talk. He said, he asked the audience, he said, what is the condition of a person who is disfellowship? They are spiritually dead. Now, brothers, how do we treat dead people? We have nothing to do with them. We don't go by the grave to check on them. We don't do that. And so the lesson is, if you have a family member, husband, wife, you know, especially people outside the house, because they have two sets of rules, one for inside the house, one for outside the house. If they're outside the house, they're good as dead. I mean, the Watchtower they have gone to great extents to make sure you understand. We have nothing to do with people who leave. We shun them. And then when they put a camera in front of them, CBS, NBC, whatever, do y'all shun people? Oh, no, we don't really shun people. I'm so serious. We don't have nothing to do with them, man. And you'd be like, y'all just lying.
Right. It's bad, man.
I'm going to get off track. I apologize. My wife be like, they don't track the day.
That's not off track. That's on track. Yeah, the... Yeah, I call it the crickets effect, that once, you know, you're going to the activities, you've got all the friends, you're at church. If you leave the church, and in Utah, it's hard because like 90% of your neighbors are all Mormon in many places in Utah. Wow. And so as soon as you leave the church, you think, oh, well, they'll still be my friends. They call it crickets. Nobody comes by. Nobody wants to know. Nobody's going to ask you why you left or why you lost your faith. It's just crickets, and all of a sudden you're alone, and you've lost your community, you've lost your friends, you've lost everyone that you care about. And your family, they won't necessarily hard shun you, but you know they'll distance themselves from you as well. And all of a sudden you'll find you're alone. You'll find out that you're alone.
Yeah, that warmth that the Bible, you know, that natural affection, high control groups, they get right in between. The natural affection that parents, mothers, children, husband and wives should have because of what is happening. Like you mentioned about the marriage, man. I mean, can you imagine you and your wife, the most important thing in her life is no longer the most important thing in your life. That literally is the recipe for a failed marriage.
Yeah.
Or if not a failed marriage, merely a marriage that's perfunctory. We're just going through the motions. I can't leave you because I can't afford. You can't leave me. But if I could get out of here, I'd be going tomorrow.
Right.
You know, and so.
Yeah. Well, you got to look at this. Okay. So when people get married, marriage in itself is a life event. It's a big life event.
Mm-hmm.
So getting married is a big life event. They say buying a home is a big life event. You know, different things, you know, having a child. Those are huge life events.
Right.
So. When you think about a person that leaves the Jehovah's Witness religion, that is considered a huge life event as well.
Mm-hmm.
So we know most people that both of them don't leave the organization, they end up getting a divorce. And the reason why most of these people end up getting divorced is because of how they got together to begin with.
Mm-hmm.
Because a lot of people got married because of the religion.
Right.
And so when they find out it's not the truth and one or two of them decide, hey, look, I'm out of here. Like if the wife leaves, this ain't the truth. She has no connection with the husband.
That's a good point. Yeah, that's a great point. That's a great point.
Yeah.
Your actual marriage, unfortunately. And we've seen this. Doesn't apply to everybody, but we've seen it happen enough. Because witnesses cannot have sex before marriage. That's one of their teachings.
Mm-hmm.
No sex before marriage. What that does is you end up getting people who, one, get married very young, and two, they grab the first thing they can find. Women will grab the first man with pants on, and men will grab the first woman that they can grab many times. So, and it's often limited to often this, their little circle of friends in their congregation, or maybe the circuit at the most. Rarely will you find people who go outside way outside. It just doesn't happen. The only reason I ended up, because I'm from North Carolina, my wife is from the Michigan area, is because I was at Bethel, I was at the headquarters, and I traveled. And that's how we end up meeting. But what ends up happening is you end up having people, because what happens, if you take any interest, and the witnesses are strict on, I mean, they are strict on this, man. They don't play no dating. If you take an interest in a sister, man, you better not sit beside her at the meeting. Oh, Lord knows. If you were to walk into a Kingdom Hall and sit beside a sister for the meeting, everybody came up, boy, they must be, they seeing each other. And so as a result, you now have to make sure that you are serious about marrying this person. You don't know this person. And so now witnesses end up marrying people that they're not really compatible with.
Proximity
and the criteria. Every Jehovah's Witness knows the criteria for marriage. Let me give you what the criteria is. This person attends all the meetings. He's regular. This person comments at the meetings. Regular. This person goes out in field service. Regular. The other stuff, well, what about kind of work you do? I don't matter. Oh, he's gonna be
a favorite team. Color.
And so all those things don't matter. I give you, even myself, when I was at Bethel at the headquarters, we were told what type of sister we had to marry. Because if you wanted to stay at the headquarters, you had to marry a certain type of sister. That sister had to be what is called a regular pioneer. She's a person who goes out 90 hours every month knocking on doors.
No, it's
70, right? Yeah, it went in the 70s, and then it used to be over 100, but they drop in the hours to keep the numbers up. you got to raise the numbers up, you know. And so we were taught. So personally, all my friends, all my buddies, when we look for a wife, we wouldn't even look at a sister who wasn't pioneer. No. Mm-hmm. If a sister had kids, not at all. Mm. Because you knew that you would not be able to stay in the corporate side of the Watchtower world. And so you had to look for sisters who were pioneering.
Right.
My wife has like four pioneer friends. They were all together, basically. Five of them. Do you know every one of those girls are married to buddies of mine who were at Bethel?
Mm.
And a couple of them, they have gone on to be just super corporate men now. They're really in the circuit working. I mean, these guys are, they're really out there. In fact, one of her roommates married a friend of mine. They were actually on the cover of the Watchtower magazine. And it is so ironic, as he's in the circuit work now. I think they're back at headquarters now. They called him out.
They've been back and forth all
Yeah, they go. Yeah, he's somebody, he's in the field, something that bringing back the corporate. He's an instructor up there. It's so ironic. The only reason I mention this is because we know them personally, and they're on the cover of one of the Watchtower, and you'll never, ever guess what the name of the Watchtower is, man. It's really just ironic. Tough. The name of the magazine is Are Jehovah's Witnesses a Cult? That is the cover of the magazine.
And when
when you see the cover of that magazine, that couple up there, that used to be our old pioneer partner, and he used to be an old buddy of mine at Bethel. He used to be a barber. He's working the barbershop. And so this is what you end up marrying. So when you leave this religion, all of a sudden you realize, my husband, you know, I don't want him. Or you look at your wife like, I don't want her. Mm. And so they end up going in different directions. And that's what we end up hearing that a lot.
See, I think what happened to us is like we knew each other for 3 years before we got married. Mm-hmm. Even though we dated long distance. So we had, you know, we got a chance to talk to each other. I even drove, he told me, he said, why don't you go visit my parents? Because he was going to a wedding in Connecticut. Where were you going? Connecticut. I was living in Maryland at the time. And he goes, why don't you drive and visit my parents in North Carolina? And so I drove all the way to North Carolina. It was like 4 hours from where I was living at the time. And I got a chance to go visit his parents even without him and had a good time, you know. So I got a chance to meet them and, you know, different things like that. So it was like we got a chance to get to know each other before we got married. So it wasn't like a six month courtship.
Yeah, we dated long, you know, our courtship was long distance. And, you know, I always tell people, you know.
And the reason why I said he was going to a wedding because he was going to be serving as a waiter at the wedding. He was going to be serving as a waiter at this wedding, because the Bethelites, when they got married, they would actually hire other Bethelites to go work at their wedding. I wasn't going up there. I don't even think my roommates were going up there for that wedding.
Going for that either.
But he just said, "Oh, you looking for something to do for the weekend? Go visit my parents." You know.
Yeah.
I got a chance to go visit them. Yeah.
I mean, it's an interesting system, because one of the things that they want you to do is to talk to your fiance or the girl you're interested in.
Mm-hmm.
Call her elders up. So I called three of her elders up. Brother JT, I'm in Bethel. I'm interested in assisting your congregation. Lady Cee, what can you tell me? She ain't good. She ain't good.
Oh man.
And vice versa. She called my elders.
Oh my
man.
God, it was like a nightmare. That one
is he a playboy? I mean, I want to know. Is he a playboy?
He was telling me. He goes. Oh, don't worry about it. You can call up the elders. They're so nice. These brothers are so nice. And this one brother, he said, "Who are you?" And I was like, "Oh my God." And so my mom said, "I told you don't be calling up them brothers and leave them people alone and this kind of stuff." And then when I told JT about it, he was like, "Oh yeah, I guess he was like used to people calling people up there." But you know what? That was like a kind of like a crack in the foundation, because you know, you're supposed to be this loving shepherd. And you got this arrangement, and I don't tell this brother that JT gave me his number, call the brothers to talk to them and whatever. And this brother was nasty. I mean, he was so nasty. I was like, oh my God, I don't want to meet him. You know, I didn't want to meet him. No.
Oh,
and I was afraid of elders too back in the day.
That's so fascinating. Yeah, we get married young. We get married way too fast. I think there may be a difference. We start having kids really early, and we have a lot of kids. You guys are a little bit different that way. Is that right?
Absolutely. In fact, Jehovah's Witnesses are basically, from the very beginning, they're really the opposite. From the early starts of this religion, witnesses were discouraged from having children. The reason why is because there's only a little time left. The world's going to end soon, and we need you to move these books out into the neighborhood, and you can have your kids in a new system. And that runs deep within this organization. You are praised when you do not have children. In fact, that is why my wife and I do not have children today. Our plan was to have our children in the new system.
Mm-hmm.
As I'm sitting here right now, man, I'm very serious. We can name over 100 couples that we personally know got no kids, and they don't want no kids.
Mm.
Most of them are either still at Bethel, or they're out in the pioneer work, or they're trying to get into the traveling work, and they don't want no kids. They're gonna have the kids in a new system.
Can I tell them what group I used to belong to? I used to belong to a club.
Tell us.
I used to belong to the AAA club. You know what that means?
Tell us.
Available after Armageddon.
Oh man.
Because I was gonna be one of those people that didn't get married until after the new system. Yep.
I'm just going to say that's another reason why Mormons are way more wealthy than Jehovah's Witnesses, because we have so many kids, and that's good for tithing in the long run. The more kids you have, the more your membership grows, and then the more money the church makes in the long run.
Yeah. Yeah. Witnesses are really discouraged from over the years, man, from having kids. I mean, when you hear people getting pregnant, I mean, it was never really celebrated, especially within certain circles.
Mm-hmm.
Those who were considered doing more for Jehovah were those who didn't have children, and they moved here and moved there. They were praised.
Right.
My mom, I'll give you a perfect example. My mom, when she got pregnant with my baby brother, I remember we were coming home from the meeting. I was sitting in the back seat. I could see my mom in the rearview mirror. Tears were running down her eyes, man. Tears were running down. The reason why is because witnesses, they take one of the statements that Jesus made about woe to the pregnant woman, woe to the pregnant woman. And the reason they use that scripture is because they liken it to, this is what Armageddon is going to be like. Well, you're going to have to run and hide from people trying to kill us. And you can't do that if you got a baby. That's why Jesus says, woe to the pregnant woman. And so my mom was pregnant with my baby brother. And brothers would give talks like, are we really trusting in Jehovah, brother? And so my mom went home, man. She was tears, because she knew that if Armageddon came and she was pregnant with my brother, it was going to be hard to run. Man, my brother's 45 years old. We still waiting for the end, you know, so.
That's actually really interesting, because the Mormon Church is called the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. The reason why it's called Latter-day Saints is because we were a millennialistic church in the beginning. But after decade and decade and decade, and we were all supposed to like gather in Independence, Missouri, and Jesus was supposed to come, but then Joseph Smith died, and we got kicked out of Missouri and Illinois, and we had to move to Utah. Over time, we've kind of dropped that teaching,
yeah.
But you guys have kept it. And some people are asking what is supposed to happen in Armageddon. So tell us a little bit about, you know, you've talked about end times. You've made references to the fact that at various points in the history of the Jehovah's Witness movement, leaders have said it's going to happen this year, it's going to happen that year, and at least 3 or 4 years have come and gone where the second coming didn't happen when the leaders had prophesied. Tell us a tiny bit about your theology as it relates to what happens when the earth is supposed to end, and anything else you want to talk about that we haven't already addressed, just because someone's asking.
Yeah, this is what Jehovah's Witnesses are taught. They're taught that we are the only true religion. Therefore, we're the only religious denomination that has any standing before God. All other religions, no standing before God. In fact, you're literally under the control of Satan the devil. Witnesses make it real black and white, us versus them. I mean, we're talking Muslim, we're talking Buddhist, Christian, it don't matter. It's just us. We got 8 guys in New York City. Now they moved to the suburbs. They're the only ones God is talking to. Nobody else.
Eight guys. And they're called what?
They're called the governing body.
Governing body. Okay.
You call them the apostles.
Yeah, right.
Witnesses call them the governing body.
Okay.
So they're the only ones who can understand the Bible. God helps them understand the Bible. They write up in the magazine. They send out to 8 million Jehovah's Witnesses who get the information, and they go to your house. This is what God wants you to know. Mm-hmm. Now, the reason witnesses come to your home is because we're giving you a warning, just like Noah. Noah said, y'all come on, get on the ark. Folks laugh. Witnesses say, we tell y'all, come on to the kingdom hall with us. That's where you're going to be safe. Y'all laugh. So witnesses realize that people who do not become a part of this religion, who do not accept the explanation of scripture as is presented by the Watchtower writers, you stand no chance of surviving Armageddon.
Mm.
And when Armageddon comes, all the governments and all the churches will be destroyed along with their followers. The only people who will be left standing, you guessed it, are Jehovah's Witnesses and those who are found favorably toward them. Because mm-hmm. See, there may be people who haven't got baptized yet, but they were studying. So they're going to come on in too. And so basically, if you work with a Jehovah's Witness, he's looking around the office realizing, y'all ain't going to make it. And that's
but the Armageddon part, she wanting to know what it's going to look like when.
All of it. All this is good. I'm loving all this.
It will be the same type of destruction that most people envision with Armageddon. Fire raining down from heaven, angels.
Total mass chaos. What's that Will Smith movie?
Independence Day? Independence Day?
It's going to be like Independence Day.
I mean, you know, the heavenly bodies will change colors, the angelic forces, because remember, Satan is going to be abyss. So, I mean, it will be total destruction. And once everything is over with, the only people who will be left standing will be Jehovah's Witnesses. And every witness, this is what they are working for. And that's why witnesses don't support community. That's why witnesses don't support stuff in the community. That's why witnesses don't have any real charity, because we ain't going to need that.
Mm.
That's why we don't believe in going to college, because there's not going to be any doctors in the new system. Everybody's going to be perfect. So why waste time going to be a doctor? Preach. Move these books. And so that impacts the whole thinking. Mm-hmm. And because it's only a short period of time, real soon. And everybody understands that. If somebody tells you, are we almost there yet? Oh, I can wait. If someone keeps telling you that, after a while, you're going to be like, man, we're going from New York to Florida. You told me it was like 2 miles. And so that's kind of the way it is for the witnesses. Witnesses now are starting to get tired. And I'm going to tell you, man, we really feel sorry for old Jehovah's Witnesses. Unlike Mormons, see, y'all guys, y'all older Mormon people, y'all were able to like have good jobs, good retirements and stuff. Mm-hmm. It ain't the case for witnesses, man. Mm. Jehovah's Witnesses gave up college. We used to go to conventions, man, all of our lives. And we would have young people walk out onto platform, 30, 40, 50,000 people. And they would make the following statement. I turned down a scholarship, full scholarship to MIT. And 40,000 people would clap. Mm. We're so happy for you. So you made such a wise choice.
Mm.
Fast forward. The Watchtower, remember, the Watchtower made a statement. They said the following. Basically, you need to face the fact that you will never have a career in this system of things because the end is so close.
Mm.
That was made in 1969.
They've been saying that for over 100 years.
Yeah.
Do you realize that if you were a young Jehovah's Witness finishing up high school in 1969, you read that and you was trying to decide what to do, and you said, well, hang on, go to school because I won't have time to even have a career in this system. Mm-hmm. Do you realize that a person who was 18 in 1969, 68, they would be retired living in Scottsdale, Arizona?
Mm.
And that story is told around the world. And what really concerns us is that we see how difficult it is for the American, the Western Jehovah's Witness, living in England and Germany, the United States and Canada. We see how rough it is for these older Jehovah's Witnesses who did not prepare for their old age. Can you imagine what it's like if you are a Jehovah's Witness living in a third world country? Oh, my goodness.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, my goodness. There are so many witnesses. The Watchtower wrote an article about should you leave your country. And a lot of witnesses got the magazine and it just went over their head. Leave the country? What are you talking about? Teenagers ain't leaving the country? Because most American kids don't leave the country. I mean, most kids in Canada don't leave the country. But in Africa, a lot of people in Africa, they may go to Europe. They'll end up in Paris or end up in Germany. Mm-hmm. And so forth. Mm-hmm. So a lot of witness kids would see other kids who would leave. They would go and go to school. They would go and they would come back. They would be doctors, lawyers, whatever. I remember a Bethelite that I knew when I was in New York. He was from the branch in Nigeria, the Lagos branch. And he told us of an experience of a witness kid. Witness kid in some villages, kids who are really outstanding at what they do, if they have the opportunity to go to college, sometimes the whole village will help pay you to get you to France or Europe somewhere so you can get your college degree and come back home and, you know, practice medicine or whatever. There was a witness kid who had the opportunity for the community to send him to Europe. Mm. And I remember this because the Bethelite told us, he said, and it didn't even register to me that this article was being used in these countries by circuit overseers and by elders. And it dealt with, should you leave your country? And the article talks about basically, no, don't leave your country. Stay right where you are. Be happy where you are. And so it was used to discourage all of these young people who could have got out of having to be a goat herder. Nothing wrong with herding goats. But if you have the opportunity to go and be a doctor who does surgery on people's brains and people's hearts, and that's what you have the skill and talents to do, your religion shouldn't be telling you not to do that. And like you said before, I've always talked to people who are Mormons, you know, y'all guys got Brigham Young, y'all built your own school.
Mm-hmm.
I understand, you know, you didn't want to go to school with worldly kids. So y'all built your own school because y'all at least understood the value of education.
Yeah.
Jehovah's Witnesses, man, we don't have no nursing homes. We don't have no schools. We don't have no hospitals. Jehovah's Witnesses don't have a soup kitchen. They don't have a soup kitchen. And so witnesses literally have nothing to do with their community. Nothing except hawking their books. That's it. Mm. And so every now and then when there's there's going to be some witnesses going to write in, well, when there's a national disaster, we help out. Yes, witnesses help out when there's a national disaster. But folks in prison, in the local jail, is oftentimes asked to come out when there's a hurricane. Help, we need to cut some trees down, guys. So it's no big deal. But witnesses do not, as an 8 million person religion, boots on the ground in 200 countries. If you were to ask Jehovah's Witnesses, can you name one charity? Give me the name of the charity and what country it's in. Witnesses could not give you the name of one charity. Yet they enjoy the tax benefits in every country they can. That's right.
But see, the problem with the Jehovah's Witness religion too is when the older population, when the people get older and they can start talking about the things that they knew, then the younger Jehovah's Witnesses are like, oh, don't listen to them, they're senile. So, you know, you can tell your story, you know, but nobody's going to listen.
No.
Because the younger group that's there, they got their youth on their side.
Yeah.
So they're not really worrying about, you know, they're still thinking the end is going to come in their lifetime. You know, but the older, we knew this couple in our congregation, and she always bragged about the three-legged tricycle she used to ride out in service, and they're like in their 80s now.
Yeah.
But the only thing about it is they do have two children, and so, you know, think about the people that don't have the kids, you know? They don't have anybody at that age.
I mean, it's one of those religions, man, where by telling people that God is going to destroy everybody around them and give them a paradise to live in, it makes it easier for them to hang in there a little bit longer,
So they're stringing people along. They're not living the best life that they can. They're not having kids if they want kids necessarily. They're not getting their education. They're not pursuing meaningful careers. They're not actually engaging in community or philanthropic efforts. They're just like plugged into the matrix, selling the books, serving the church, building the church, helping the church make more and more and more money, but siphoning off the best years of their lives, not living the best lives that they can.
That's a way. That's. Let me just give you just a perfect example. When I went to work at the world headquarters of Jehovah's Witnesses, they used to tell us all the time, "This is your home. You can stay as long as you want. This is your home." In fact, they had this little thing. It was kind of an unwritten thing. After you made 5 years, you was considered vested. In other words, there were certain things you could ask for that you would get because you were considered a member of the Bethel family. Mm-hmm. We used to always say, this is a family and this is your home and you can stay as long as you want. A little over a year ago, they let over 1,000 Bethelites go home. They told them, we need you to leave and go home and get a job. They let people go who had been working for the Watchtower Society for 10, 20, 30, 40 years. There is a guy right now, as I am talking to you right now, him and I flew from Norfolk, Virginia to Newark Airport and caught the shuttle over to Watchtower headquarters at the same time. He is still there. He is still there. When they asked these guys to leave, they gave them no severance, and you cannot apply for unemployment because you are not considered an employee. So you have people who went to Bethel like I did at 19 and at 49, 58, 52, 56, they were told, go now and get a job. And your job at Bethel might have been working in cleaning. You've been in cleaning for 35 years, been in the laundry 42 years. Shoe shop, maintenance shop. Everybody doesn't have a skill at Bethel. And so they let these guys go. And the worst part about it, man, I'll be honest with you, they didn't like send a letter out to all the congregations of Jehovah's Witnesses saying, we are letting some brothers go. We want you brothers to welcome them in, help them get jobs, find houses, get these brothers on their feet because they've been serving God up here for the last 25 years. Man, they ain't saying anything. So you have guys who left Bethel. They could not leave and complain. When they went back home, they couldn't say, man, they did us wrong, man. You couldn't say that. Mm-hmm. You could have been, I'm so happy because what they did, that's how they did it. This is a new assignment from Jehovah. No job.
Yeah.
So this was their new assignment, man. And so you couldn't complain about your new assignment that you just got from God.
It's terrible because when they got rid of the district overseers, I remember this one sister was telling us that this one district overseer, he and his wife, they got their letter that they were being terminated from the work as a district overseer, and the husband dropped dead of a heart attack the next day. And you know, in this religion, women are not treated as well as the men. And so if they were a couple and this man was, you know, still living, he probably would have been able to be, you know, bought into the fold with some other brothers and different things like that. But I don't know what happened to his wife.
Women are not thought of too highly. Just to give you an example, in the Watchtower, there are different levels of elders. You have like the local elders. Then you have what's called the traveling overseer. He's known as a circuit overseer. And they had another layer called the district overseer. So a circuit overseer takes care of 20 congregations, and a district overseer would take care of 20 circuit overseers. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was a straight up hierarchy. This straight up hierarchy. You put it on a graph, you're like, oh man, it's like a business. It does. It is a business. Regional. In fact, they used to refer to Jehovah's Witness congregations as companies. They call them the Christian Congregation of Jehovah's Witnesses now. But when they first started, when the Russell, this was the company, because they was moving books, man. It was moving books. It was the company. Company in Chicago, the company, you know. And so as a result of that, you now have these people who were told to go home. And these people have been in these positions for 20, 30, 40 years, man. I mean, you talking about cold-blooded? I mean, that is some cold-blooded stuff. Mm. And that's what happens in corporate America. Mm-hmm. Witnesses have been told for years, God does not lay off. Well, we see that ain't true. We see that ain't true.
It reminds me a little bit of the Sea Org with the Scientologists. It sounds like, yeah, you guys have corporate workers that give their lives to the church and make almost nothing. And at the end of the day, they're kind of not taken care of. It reminds me of Scientology in that way.
It does. I made $80 a month.
For how long?
Oh, wow, was it? We got a raise because
6 years.
If the subway raises the fare in New York City, you can get a raise. So I got a raise from 80 to 90 because the subway. This is so you could travel back and forth to the Kingdom Hall.
Let me ask you to tell the story. I was listening to your podcast, your YouTube channel, which is amazing, and you told the story of how, let's just say in the mid 1900s, a Jehovah's Witness who was called to serve in the military had the option of doing some sort of replacement service work, and then people ended up going to jail. Can you tell that story? Because that is one of the most heartbreaking stories I've ever heard about the people that were going to jail and why, and then what happened when the church just miraculously changed its policies and what that did to people's lives. Because I don't think my listeners are not going to believe this story.
Yeah. This is a teaching that revolves around what is known as alternative service. Mm-hmm. Most countries recognize that they may have citizens who, because of conscious reasons, they don't want to serve in the military. And my wife and I, we were talking about this a while back, how this impacts Jehovah's Witnesses in such a horrible way. What happened was, at one time, witnesses could actually serve in the military. I remember Fred Franz, the president of the Watchtower, would say that witness men would serve, you know, in the military. Then the Watchtower came out with the position, we will not serve in the military at all. So as a result, people went to jail. And this is all around the world. So what happened was, a lot of countries, they created what's known as alternative service. So instead of you going to prison, you will do alternative service. Work at a hospital, work on a road crew. You know, that's what you would do as alternative in lieu of going to prison. Well, the Watchtower, in their effort to always be different, they took the position that we're not taking that either. We're not going to go to prison. We're going to go to prison instead of actually taking those alternative service jobs. So literally thousands of people went to prison. In fact, one of the guys I personally know from North Carolina, he's one of my mentors, he actually went to prison during the Vietnam War. He got his draft letter. He went to the elders and said, brothers, anything I can do. So I go to prison. Circuit overseer was coming in town. He said, well, we'll ask the circuit overseer, is there any new information from the Watchtower? Circuit overseer gets there. He says, well, let me call Brooklyn and see if there's any new information, and we'll let you know. And sure enough, he called. He came back and said, nope, you're going to have to go to prison, or you'll be excommunicated / disfellowship. So like a good witness, thought he was dangling the lines then, three Hebrew boys, he went to prison, 18, 19 years old. Of course, when he gets out, he's a felon. He struggles to get a job. And of course, it's on his record. Every job application. You ever been a felon?
Yep.
So it impacted him just as a man coming out of prison. But here's the kicker. The Watchtower was trying to get into the country of Bulgaria. That's right. They was trying to get legal recognition. And Bulgaria said, nah, we're not letting y'all get legal recognition. There's two things about y'all guys we don't like, and you ain't coming in here and getting legal status. You tell our young men not to serve in the military. You won't let them take alternative service, and you won't let people have blood. And we disagree with both of those. So unbeknown to a lot of witnesses, behind the scenes, the Watchtower was trying to negotiate with Bulgaria to get this thing through the door. And all of a sudden, man, one of their teachings on alternative service out of the clear blue sky, witnesses had no idea where this came from. The teaching was changed. Oh, you can take the alternative service job now. You can go ahead and take that now. When they changed the teaching, thousands of young men were still in prison.
Around what year was this, approximately?
This was like, what, I think around the 90s.
Okay.
They were still in prison.
Mm.
Because this is one of the reasons why we end up leaving.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, because I knew somebody who went to prison for this. And man, when this is the kicker. This is probably the worst part of all. And I can send you the article and stuff if you like. You can put it in your notes. The Watchtower, man, they had the nerve to blame. They blamed the people who went to prison. Mm. They said, your conscience was just too strict. That's why you went to prison. Your conscience was too strict. And man, it just crushed people all around the world because people are saying, it wasn't my conscience. You told me it's what God said I had to do. It wasn't a conscious matter. But the Watchtower played it as it was a conscious matter. And then a little later on, they decided to do a follow-up article. I mean, the Watchtower, man, they can put gas on the fire. The Watchtower wrote an article. The article deals with, do you feel you were unjustly treated? Do you feel that God unjustly treated you? Because you had to go to jail. That's amazing, man. That is absolutely amazing. Do you feel that you suffered needlessly was the name of the article. In other words, you suffered, went to prison. Do you think it was worth it? It was needless. Of course it was needless. I went to prison because you said that God said I had to go. And then you're talking about, well, you only got to go. And we really didn't tell you that you had to do it. I mean, man, it was like, And so that was one of the cracks in my foundation in this religion, because I had always been taught that you do what the slave says. And it was along that time period, man, along with a couple other things, a couple of the doctrines they changed. I was like, they don't know what they're talking about, man. And I told my wife, I said, they don't know what they're talking about. Yes, they taught us not to lie, cheat, and steal. And now, you know, if I come to your house and you got a $20 bill on the table, I'm not going to steal it because I've learned that. You work for that. You work hard. I shouldn't take it. So, yes, they did teach us some good things. But, man, a lot of things that they were teaching, they were just making up on the fly. And they were selling it as this is what God says. And people were making decisions. As we often say on our channel, they took basically human opinions, elevated it to divine status, and told you this is what God says to do. And yeah. So at that point, man, you know, I know how the system works. I know how the system works. If there's one thing I know this organization, especially the way that on the policy side, like the back of my hand, because I was taught that. My mentor taught me that.
Yeah, he was all in this religion.
Yeah,
and it's really interesting that he would the experiences that he's relating, because when he brought it to me, it didn't mean anything a lot to me, because I was in it because I just thought this was the truth, and I wasn't in the doctrines like that. And we have a friend that, you know, we met him a couple years ago, and his wife is still a witness, and he is an apostate, you know, if you want to call it that.
He's an apostate.
He's like, he ain't going back to no Kingdom Hall. And he was an elder in the congregation. He was at Bethel as well.
Yeah, he was.
and just a nice guy. And he was like, his wife doesn't know anything about these doctrines. He said she doesn't care anything about any of the stuff that, you know, he's talking about right now. You know, this stuff goes over her head. She doesn't even know what she believes in. All she knows is she's got this sense of community. She's at the Kingdom Hall where she's supposed to be, because she's going to cash in on her Paradise Earth stock really soon. You know, so there's two types of people.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
People that
yeah.
believe and know these doctrines the way JT does, and people like myself who just went along with the okie doke. We're supposed to be here. He's taking the lead. He's my husband. I'm at the meeting because I'm supposed to be there.
Yeah, on Mormon Stories, we had an episode once where we talked about two types of Mormons, validity Mormons and utility Mormons. A validity Mormon cares if it's true. And more often than not, men tend to be more validity Mormons than utility Mormons. A utility Mormon stays because it works. It is good for them. It's a system that just kind of, you know, it's a great way to raise your kids. It's a way to keep your husband from straying, right? And that's a way that we've often framed it. Let me ask you guys this. So obviously that story about military service is just heartbreaking.
It is.
There are ways that religions just really, we could talk about, oh, it helps with your family. It helps if you're poor. It helps you find community and friends. Sometimes there are ways that a religion turns deadly or destructive. What are some of the main ways that you've seen the Jehovah's Witness religion ruin lives? We've talked about it, breaking up families, ending marriages. Do you guys want to talk a couple things that my listeners want to know about? Do you want to talk about blood transfusions and people dying?
Yeah. Yeah.
I would love to hear you talk about your LGBTQ policies, about how the church can treat their gay, lesbian, bisexual, transgender members. What are some of the ways the church, main ways that the church significantly harms people?
I wasn't caught up in the blood transfusion situation, but I had to have surgery when I was 17. And I had no blood written all over my records. And the doctors were prepared to give me no blood if I needed it. And it was the same hospital that I didn't need no blood, thank God. But some years later, there was a young kid in our congregation, and he had gotten hit by a car, and he needed a blood transfusion. And the doctor tried to get a court order to get this young boy, get him some blood. And it was too late because he died. And they were in our congregation. And it was really, really sad, you know, watching that, you know, watching this young boy. He was still a teenager. And he died because the parents believed that he should not have a blood transfusion. And you can just multiply this all over the world with Jehovah's Witnesses. I think the blood transfusion is the biggest thing. And they used to have a policy where you couldn't get kidney transplants too. And so I think they changed that. You could tell the story about the couple in our congregation about that.
Yeah. I think the worst is the blood transfusion. And it's for many reasons. Let me just give you a couple examples. One of the reasons is because the Jehovah's Witnesses, those in the upper leadership, they have no knowledge of the subject matter. The people who work, and this is very important to understand, the people who work in the writing department, the guys who work down there and write these articles, you need to understand where the vast majority of those guys come from. These are not guys who have journalism background. Most of these guys, they come from the cleaning department, the laundry department. That's right, scaffolding crew, truck drivers. Because the writing department is considered one of the top departments to work in at Bethel. It's the top. So like two or three, service department and writing department. And so where these guys come from, they come from basically two places, either out of the field as a circuit overseer, district overseer, or they are homegrown. These are guys who have faithfully done what they're told in cleaning when they was 19. They then gave them another job at 25. They faithfully did that. And they have simply just worked up through the ranks. And now they're down there writing the articles, writing the articles. Most of them have no college background. None. None. They are not experts in Greek, Hebrew, the language. None of that. None of that. See, listen, in most churches, they have what's called scholars. And the Watchtower does something real cool. They will quote. But in their publications, they'll say, Bible scholars say ABC, Bible scholars say CBS. Okay. They won't oftentimes tell you who these Bible scholars are. The reason why is because many of these Bible scholars, they're preachers in other denominations. They're pastors. That's right. See, in other denominations, people have to go to college. They have to take classes in Greek and Hebrew. And so they at least have some background in the subject. Witnesses don't. They just take Greek for dummies down in the writing department, and that's basically it. Mm. That is why you will never hear anyone ever reference a Jehovah's Witness scholar from the Watchtower organization. Now, there are people who got PhDs in this organization, but the writers, they're not going to be cited as scholars because they're not. And so that's where this issue with this blood came up. This is so bad because of the way in which they approached it. Remember, everything is from God. Witnesses start out teaching that you cannot take either whole blood or any blood fractions. You cannot take whole blood or anything derived from blood. Okay, let's go with that then. Let's just go with that. A few years later, the Watchtower says, but you can take certain blood fractions now. They literally created two lists, a list of approved fractions that you can take from blood, and a list of unapproved fractions from blood. If you were to ask a Jehovah's Witness, can you take me to the Word of God and show me how you came up with these two lists, where it came from? They couldn't do it. Now, here's the magic part. The magic part is certain items in one list could move from one side to the other. So you have a religion that says you can't take whole blood or anything fractionated from blood. And we can understand that. If someone wanted to sell you a hot car and you say, man, I don't buy stolen cars, man, get out of my face, man. I ain't buying no stolen car. If he went around the corner and cut it up into a shop and came back and wanted to see the hubcaps, could you now buy it? No, it's the same hot car that you had before. All of a sudden, witnesses had these two lists. One was approved by God, one wasn't. And at times, God would take one thing out of one list and put it in the other. If you look at the history of Jehovah's Witnesses and the teaching of blood, you will see how one day it's a sin, the next day it's not. Why is that so dangerous? Why is that so bad? I want you to think about this. You have a couple, two sons, two boys in a car accident. They need blood. Both of them about to die. The witnesses, they gather together. They're holding tight. They're encouraging the couple. Don't take the blood. Remember, the Bible says abstain from blood. And this fraction that this child needs is not on that list. All of a sudden, one child dies. Didn't get the blood fraction that he needed. 3 days later, the Watchtower can come out with a magazine like they did. And now hemoglobin is now acceptable. So these same parents can now turn around and go right back to the hospital, go right back to the doctors and all the staff there and says, you can give my second son that hemoglobin that you couldn't give my first son last week. Mm. When you have doctrines that can change like that, as I say, and we always say, when you start jacking with people's lives, man, that's a problem. That religion has a problem when you can jack with people's lives. There are people we have talked to over the years. There was a man, his wife was beautiful. She was in a fire. Her face was burned. The insurance company says, we will provide coverage for the grafts. It's not going to be a problem. Witnesses couldn't take skin grafts along with transplants and things of that nature. His wife, every day, this man had to tell his wife, she's beautiful. She's beautiful with her face the way it was. His religion wouldn't even allow him to have some type of surgery done that would give her some skin grafts to improve her look. And yet he had to tell her every day she's beautiful. All because of his religion. All because of his religion.
And they wouldn't even let you store your own blood.
No. No, you can't store your own blood. And so when you see teachings that literally morph, because that's the whole point. On Monday, this is a teaching of God. On Monday, it's a teaching of God. On Friday, God changed his mind. And so, unlike in the Catholic Church, they changed their teaching on eating the meat. Well, whether you ate a hot dog on Friday, not nobody died from it. But when you have teachings where people are going to end up dying, that is so sad. When I was an elder, I served in the position in the congregation known as a secretary. And one of the responsibilities of the secretary is every year you go over what's called the blood documents with all the congregation. So witnesses can get a little blood card and they get a little form of, you know, it's a form they fill out about what type of treatments they want in terms of blood and transfusions, all this kind of stuff. And I remember the other elders, they would just laugh like, JT, you got to get that talk, man. I'm glad you getting it because I don't know what that stuff is talking about. And on this form, man, you would see medical terms that I had no idea what they were.
Mm.
And then after the meeting, you would have all of these witnesses who would come to you, Brother JT, is this okay if we take this? And so the Watchtower literally had a checklist of what you could take and what you couldn't. And do you know, man, what so many of, especially the older Jehovah's Witnesses would tell me? Well, Brother JT, I'm just gonna avoid all of it just to be safe.
Yeah.
Even when they were allowed to take it, they didn't know they could actually take it.
Yeah.
My wife said, to mention you, an experience we had in our congregation. We had a very unusual experience. We had a couple in our hall. The husband lost his kidney, started shutting down. So as a result, he needed to have a kidney transplant. So they was doing all these tests. They was trying to find a match and this and that and this and that. Couldn't find anything. His wife, she says, I'm going to take the test. She took the test, man, and she came back as a match for her husband.
Mm.
So we had called an elders meeting, and we were discussing, okay, now, brothers, we're going to have both husband and wife are going to have surgery at the same time. They both are going to be down, and they got kids. So we need to see if we can set something up so we can have some of the sisters bring some food by and make sure they're taken care of, because both of them are going to get cut up inside and, you know, at the same time. You're going to take that, cut one and put in the other. And so we're sitting by there discussing this, you know, as a body of elders. And one of the senior elders, older elder, he was red.
Yeah, like, keeping up with his magazine.
Yeah, he was red back like this. Yeah. And so when we finished, the presiding overseer at the time, he said, anybody got any additional thoughts? Anything you want to say or anything? He read back, oh, that's fine, brothers. But you see, before we can do that, it looks like we might need to have a judicial committee meeting, because you can't take transplants, brothers. And I looked at this other elder like, what is old brother Sims talking about? And so, and you can see the elder in the room like, and the presiding officer, he finally said, Brother Sims, the society has changed their position on transplants, so we won't be needing to have a judicial meeting in this fellowship. The couple, you know, so he wasn't even up to speed. He wasn't even up to date on what he could and could not do. And when you think about, there are men all around the world, from first world countries to third world countries, who are sitting in rooms making decisions like that. Some of these men got fourth and fifth and sixth grade education, and they're going to make decisions about people's lives.
Mm-hmm.
That's jacked up.
Yeah.
However you want to look at it.
Yeah.
And, but you know what's really interesting too about this blood situation, because the friend of mine, when she was telling me about when she they weren't going to give them her blood for her baby, and it was so, when she tells the story, you just get chills.
Mm.
And so it was a couple of times, I think she had one time where she had one child, and they actually went into the brother, and I didn't know they were doing this. She said the brothers came to my hospital room and they barred the doctors from the room. They kept them out of her hospital room, kept them out. But she said when she had her daughter, and her daughter needed just a drop of blood. She told me, she said, after all the brothers left the hospital room, she went to the doctor and she begged that doctor. She said, please save my baby, please. And she knew she wasn't supposed to give that baby blood. So what the doctors did was they forced an injunction, and they were able to get her baby blood. And the little girl, how old is, because she's, my goodness, she's in the second grade now, I think. And she said, and she was on our channel telling her story. We talked to so many people that I can't get the dates right, time right, people right. Sure. So the bottom line is, they were able to save her daughter. Her daughter's like in the second grade. And she said that they went to the doctor. You see, they left. They woke up and they found out this wasn't the truth, and they left too. She said when they left this religion, she said they got a chance to go to the doctor that saved her baby's life, and they went to him. She said she cried like a baby in that doctor's office telling him how happy she was that he saved her baby's life. They couldn't believe it.
Yeah, that story is so powerful because, unbeknown to a lot of people, when the witnesses leave the room, many witnesses have allowed the doctors to give blood to their child. What most Jehovah's Witnesses want, if they are found in a situation like that, is they want the courts to make the decision. Mm-hmm. So you'll get the administration of the hospital. We're going out to get the judge to give it to him. And unbeknown to the elders and the brothers who are there, the family's like, thank God they're going to do it because I ain't got to do it. And so they're able to maintain what they consider a clear conscience. Most people do not realize that Jehovah's Witnesses have an entire system. Listen to me carefully. They have an entire system to deal with the issue of blood in hospitals. It is called the Hospital Liaison Committee. It is a selection of three elders in practically every city and locality around the world. Here in the Washington, D.C. area, we have brothers who serve on the Hospital Liaison Committee. Their job is to go to hospitals when witnesses are there and facing blood. And they meet with the administrators. They meet with the doctors. I remember a brother, I had a conversation with, he left this organization. He used to be on the Hospital Liaison Committee in his state. And he said, JT, he says, man, sometimes you feel like an idiot. You're sitting in a room with 8, 9, 10 people, administrators, directors, all kinds of surgeons and doctors. All these men got medical degrees. And they're discussing something that you, because you work at the, you're a bus driver. You drive Metro. Okay, you bust your job, but you got your suit and tie on. You're looking good. And these guys are discussing medical terms that you don't know nothing about. Nothing about. And he said he could see as they was explaining the Watchtower's position on stuff, he could see they were laughing. I'm like, well, you just ignorant as you can get. Ain't no difference in cutting the blood over here and cutting this fraction is the same as that fraction. It does the same thing. And so they understood that what the witnesses were arguing made no sense. See, at least when they taught take no blood, at least that was clear cut. But when you start cutting the blood into pieces and saying God is okay with this one, but he's not okay with that one, y'all guys a bunch of idiots, man. Get out of our conference right now. Yeah. And so he said he would feel like an absolute idiot sitting back there trying to explain something about this issue, knowing he didn't know what he was talking about. Because all he had was the talking points that the Watchtower legal department had sent down for him to read.
That's ridiculous.
It's ridiculous.
I kind of feel like this is going to sound like religious bigotry, but I kind of feel like there should be a law where no one can say they speak on behalf of God, because that's the problem.
That gives
any human or organization way too much power when they can claim to speak for God.
Yeah, you're right. That is probably. And that is the whole problem.
Yeah.
As a Jehovah's Witness, you grew up believing that those 8 guys in New York, they speak for God himself.
Yeah, and they're just making it up. It's like you said, they're just making it up, as they go along. Yeah. What do you, really quickly, do you know what's the policy on gay, lesbian, bisexual, transgender individuals. Do you know the policy of the Jehovah's Witness Church, and has that caused, in Mormonism, there's an epidemic of LGBT Mormons taking their lives, of young Mormon kids dying by suicide. Is that an issue in the Jehovah's Witness movement?
An issue, I'm not for sure if it's an issue. And the reason why I say this is because of the way they handle it. In the congregation I was in, there was a gay gentleman. He had left this organization, and when he got AIDS, he came back to this organization and he was reinstated, and he became a Jehovah's Witness in good standing, even though everybody knew he was part of the gay community for many, many years. It's important to understand how Jehovah's Witnesses handle this. If a person is gay, if they have gay tendencies, and this is how elders are taught. If a person is gay, if he don't practice his homosexuality, then he's okay. He can have gay feelings, and he might lust after men, just like men lust after women. That's just his shortcoming, like my shortcoming. I'm lusting after, you know, other folks. So that's how the witnesses view it. That is his burden to bear until the new system. Once you get in the new system, God gonna make him a full man. Right now, while he's here, and so this is the way the witnesses view this. You can be a homosexual, gay person, but you can't practice it. You can't practice it.
Yeah.
So as a result, most witnesses, if you are a young kid or a young child, you know how the organization feels about it. And so as a result, you have no one to really talk to, because this is not something they talk about. So there is no lesbian gay community that's going to be a part of the Jehovah's Witnesses. That's just not going to happen. So people instead will remain, quote unquote, in the closet because of all the blowback that you have. And so as long as the person doesn't practice it, he will remain. So for all practical purposes, he's got to just deal with that.
If
they do practice it, they will be excommunicated/disfellowship. That is an absolute fact. Unless they apologize or they can show that they made a mistake, I sinned and fell short, please keep me in the organization, brothers. But other than that, they'll probably be disfellowship.
Okay. And see, the thing about the suicide is they do have a high rate of suicides in the religion with the gay and lesbian, because we've been, you know, getting emails and stuff like that from on our channel. And somebody said that they just heard that somebody just committed suicide because of that same situation.
Yeah, it's not something that you can openly, it's not something that a person who is gay would feel, a gay Jehovah's Witness would not want to approach the elders and say, brothers, you know, I'm gay.
Okay. What about, I know this is a big deal. What about the church covering up sexual predators and sexual abusers and kind of like punishing victims and protecting predators? I know that's been a big deal for you guys, as it has been for us, but do you guys just want to talk to that really quick?
Yeah, just real quick. It's the problem that churches in general have, and witnesses more so, because the witnesses are really image conscious. The witnesses have a perfect image that they want to maintain. And so what would happen is, in the past, and they may change because of the law that's on the back of their neck, as it were. What would happen is, if someone approached the elders about their child being molested by someone in the congregation, witnesses believe that the elders are qualified to handle this issue, and it is best handled in-house. And one of the questions that they would often ask a victim, well, Sister Davis, you know, you got the mom and the little girl back there, right? They would say, well, Sister Davis, Jehovah has forgiven the brother for the mistake he made. He apologized. The congregation elders, we've forgiven the brother. Can't you and your daughter have it in your heart to forgive the brother? Jehovah forgave him. We forgave him. So the burden is now on you, sister. And so you're sitting back there like, well, my little girl just got raped. Well, and so they're telling you, this is what you need to do. Or if you want to go to the police. Now, what would happen is, in my sense, the culture is important to understand. Elders probably would not directly say, sister, you cannot go to the police and tell this. This is what they would say. How you think this is going to make Jehovah's name look in the community? We're in a small community, sister. P- people don't like us already. We're trying to build a Kingdom Hall up the street. We're trying to get the paperwork through down at the county. And now we're going to have this going into the newspaper. Now, if you want to go, it's up to you, sister. But you need to understand the ramifications of you going forward. And so they didn't tell us she couldn't go, but they set up a scenario where you don't want to go.
Mm-hmm.
And so as a result, these cases were handled in-house. I just spent, check this out. Less than a year ago, man, I just found out the congregation I grew up in, North Kakilaki, the congregation I grew up in, we had 3 molestation cases in that hall. I never knew that. Never knew that.
Mm-hmm.
And because it was handled privately, everything, one of the questions that elders ask when we go into a judicial meeting, this is probably one of the first questions we ask. So who knows about this? Outside this room, who know about this? That's the first question we ask. And because of that, that will determine how that case many times will be handled. If nobody knows it outside the room, it stays in the room. Like that thing, what was it, Las Vegas? Stays in Vegas, okay? Mm-hmm. That's the way witnesses operate for decades. And mm-hmm. it's only because of the law. Witnesses are taught, when you have a question, you call the Watchtower Legal Department. And if you live now, let me just show you just how crazy this is. We live here in the Washington, D.C. area. D.C., Maryland, and Virginia. I can literally cross into Virginia in about 10 minutes. And in 5 minutes, I can go across the 14th Street Bridge and then come back into Virginia coming on South Capitol. So I can literally cross into two states and a jurisdiction in less than 25, 30 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
So you could have a different law that applies in each state. So if your daughter got molested in Maryland, the elders might be in a state where it's not reporting. Yet just 10 minutes across the river, across the river into Virginia, you're in the reporting state. Mm-hmm. And then you go into D.C., that's a reporting state. So depending on where your child is molested will determine what the elders will do.
Mm-hmm.
And that is the type of stuff this is one of the problems this organization is having. We were just, when I was at Bethel, man, just a little side piece. When I was at Bethel, the Watchtower had about 12 attorneys who worked with about 12, the staff was about total about 12. And so support people. The Watchtower now is pushing a staffing of over 200 people that works in the legal department because they're fighting so many cases all over this country. And the Watchtower has branches in 85 countries around the world.
Mm.
And one of the things that witnesses are very proud of, very proud, we do the same thing everywhere. So the way elders are handling a case in Chicago is the same way they're going to handle it somewhere else. And that is, we're going to do it according to the society's directive. So when this thing goes to court, attorneys are like, y'all guys, y'all set yourselves up real bad. So it's very unfortunate, and they do blame the victim. One of the questions, and someone has sent this to me, I got to find it. One of the questions that they would actually ask the victim, man, I couldn't believe this. And they have, and you can see the form number down at the bottom, S34, S23. These are forms they use. One of the questions was, you asked the victim how they felt while he was being molested. Did you feel any pleasure? And the problem, of course, man, is most of the elders, man, we didn't go to school for childhood behavior. We didn't go to school for psychology. So you got men who ain't got no qualifications, none, no early childhood development. And that's why for years, until it became such a public thing, you would have an 8, 9, 10-year-old little girl sitting in the same room with her mama and daddy and 3 elders and the perp. And she has to describe in detail. One of the things that we talked about in one of our videos about the judicial meetings that elders have with Jehovah's Witnesses, especially if it involves some type of sexuality, fornication. The questions that the person, especially women, the questions that they're going to be asked, man, are off the chain. Who on top? Did he insert this? Did you do this? Did you do that? Did you? I mean, it's no bars limit. And here's the kicker. If you have a sister back there and she refuses to answer the question, that will be held against her. Did y'all notice she won't cooperate when we asked her that question about who was on top? You notice what she said, right? She didn't say nothing. And so that's just how ridiculous this internal tribunal takes place with people's lives. This is the part of the Jehovah's Witnesses that people outside know nothing about. When you are studying the Bible with Jehovah's Witnesses, there is no chapter.
Right.
It goes over judicial stuff.
Yeah.
There's no chapter. Mm-hmm. And so I look back now, man, as an elder, and you know, I was a young elder and I was groomed. You think that this is the way it's handled because these mm-hmm. are senior elders, 25 years being an elder. You was appointed 3 weeks ago. We're going to show you the ropes, JT. And so the questioning, how it's done, you think this is right. You think you're trying to peer and get to the truth. And I look back now, man, it's sad. It's just sad.
Mm.
And the women, we just followed blindly.
Yeah.
And we thought that the husbands were, you know, like, you know, as a woman, you can think. And, you know, like, even in our lives now, after we left the Watchtower,
yeah,
you know, I'm like entrepreneurial. I do things. I've always been doing my own business. And, you know, I work full time, too. But, you know, you were told that you can't do that. And I remember this sister told me, she was like, you let Brother JT take care of that, you know, but I'm strongly for my business and I don't need a man to tell me that I can't do this because he's going to do this, you know, and that's how it is in the Jehovah's Witnesses. And it's like one of the things that we have an issue with the women is some of them don't work. And so they could probably be more, they could probably make more money than their husbands, you know, because of the way they work.
Mm-hmm.
But because they're told you should be at home and doing all the things that a wife should do, you shouldn't be trying to work a job.
Mm.
And my mother, I don't really think my mom didn't work a job because of being, my dad was not a witness when I was growing up, but I think my mom chose not to work because of my brother getting killed because she was not home. He was with a babysitter. And I think that's why she didn't work. But when she got older, she was so mad when she found out this wasn't the truth. And she said, I should have had a military career. I should have been.
Mm-hmm.
She was realizing that she should have been working a job, but mom didn't work a job.
Mm-hmm.
So what ended up happening was, and I tell women this all the time, I let them know, I understand you want to work. You don't want to work a job. You want your husband to go out there and work his job and you're going to be at home. And you're going to be the Ozzie and Harriet relationship. I understand people want to do that. I want to quit my job every day.
Mm-hmm.
But I realized that you need your own money.
Mm-hmm.
And my mother, when my mother got sick, and I'm telling you, I've been juggling one salary. Well, not what my dad got multiple streams of income, but he's got two people to care for. And the amount of money that they need to that he needs to have coming in. I don't know how I've been juggling this money and paying these bills. I guess, and I'm caring for their I'm taking care of his money. Mm-hmm. And I make sure that I pay her assisted living. And then he's in another place. They're in two different places because my mom's illness, my dad can't be with her right now. So she's in assisted living in one place. And he is in, because he worked for the military, he's in a military place, you know, where he could stay because he's a vet. And so he's got these veteran benefits that he could tap into. And so he's able to live as an independent. But because my mom did not work a job, you know, it's really, really hard for my father to try to pay bills on her end and also have a measure of life for himself. So I always tell women, if you don't do nothing else, work part-time, do something, have some money coming in, you know?
Yeah. That's a huge problem in our church too. When a couple goes through a faith crisis and maybe one or both leave the church, oftentimes that destabilizes the marriage. Sometimes that leads to divorce or something else. And the women never got their degrees. Oftentimes they never got careers. Now there's a divorce and the women are just like, I don't know. I don't even know where to start. I'm like 40, 45 years old. I've got four kids. How in the world am I going to go back to school with four kids and start a career? It's a real problem. Let me ask you this, Lady Cee. I understand that the Jehovah's Witnesses are a patriarchy, just like the Mormon Church. Can you talk about the ways, really quick, in which women are kind of second class citizens in the church, if that's the case?
Yeah, well, you know, they treat you bad. You know, you can't speak up. I mean, you know, like when we were Jehovah's Witnesses, I was a freelance instructor, and I would teach computers and stuff like that. And I went to the Kingdom Hall one day, and I saw this brother, and he was trying to take a handwritten sheet where he was trying to keep track of all the books and everything. You know, and so I couldn't just walk up to him and say, hey, you know what? I got an idea for you. You can use an Excel spreadsheet and you can put all these names in here and alphabetize them, you know, and whatnot. I had to go to my husband and tell him so that he could go tell this brother.
Oh.
Because I was tired of waiting in this long line for him to work with this little handwritten sheet where he was trying to keep track of all these literature that he was trying to give out. And so I couldn't go up to him and tell him that. And I was like, I know what I'm talking about.
Why can't you? You can't. Why?
I couldn't go up to him and tell him that.
Why?
Because I'm a woman.
Mm.
I can't tell him or give him some ideas for doing that. Mm.
She needs to be in subjection and submission.
You know, so I went.
No,
JT.
She needs to know her role.
Right. And just little things like, I remember the sisters told me, this one sister told me, she said, I like this sister and these two sisters in the congregation because they share their husbands, you know, because they let their husbands go do things with other sisters. The people that didn't have husbands, you know, they look at other women and they think you're holding us other sisters back because women, you don't get any respect in the congregation. You can't marry somebody that's not a witness. So you can go and get this other brother to help you out with different things that you need help with. You know, and women are not supposed to show any leadership. So like if I was leading, let's say I'm the breadwinner in my family. I'm not supposed to be telling people that. You're not supposed to tell people that you are, or you can't tell people your successes, or you can't tell people, you know, you couldn't have a disagreement with your husband in public, you know, or you couldn't make people think that you came up with this idea. Or I remember Watchtower articles that would talk about the husband has the last say. And I remember this one magazine that came out in the Watchtower, and it was talking about all the things that husbands and wives would have to do when it came to making decisions. And they broke it all down to the situation with going on vacation. It was still the husband that had to have the last say on where you were going to go on vacation. And they went round and round and round at the Watchtower study. And at the end of the day, the husband had the last word. So no matter what you did, you had to stand 10 feet behind your husband. You couldn't have an idea, say it was your idea. You always had to dumb it down. You always had to make people feel like it was your husband's idea, or you would be looked at as being a Jezebel. You just couldn't be yourself. And there's nothing wrong with, you know, a woman knowing different things because you're two different people. So you and your husband have different skill sets.
Mm-hmm.
You have different backgrounds.
Mm-hmm.
You're different people. And so you may have a fix to something. You may be the one in the house fixing cars. My cousin, I have a cousin. She, whenever something broke down in their house, she fixed it. Her husband didn't fix nothing. She was like Mr. Fix It, you know? But she wouldn't be walking around telling everybody that she's fixing the refrigerator and fixing flat tires and stuff like that, you know? But I'm just saying, the woman has to always show that she's the weaker vessel in this religion.
Oh, this is so fantastic. It's tragic and it's so powerful to hear you talking about this, Lady Cee. So the eight or the nine, the governing council, is that what they're called?
The governing body.
Are there any women in the governing body?
No.
Never. There's never been a woman in the governing body ever.
And they probably won't be.
What about in the highest levels of the organization at church headquarters? Are the women leading there?
No. This is a male. This is a male. This is a it's a male focused organization.
What about at the church level? The elders. Are there any female elders?
No.
Well, they have some elderettes.
Some elders.
I'm being facetious.
These are like elders' wives sometimes.
But sometimes I'm gonna tell you what. Some women. A lot of times we talk a lot, and in the congregation, you will have women that you can tell that they're telling their husbands what to do. So they have their husbands might be elders, but they don't read some things about those wives too.
Right.
Because in this one congregation that I was in Michigan, now the women, they did make up, they did choose the colors of what the Kingdom Hall colors was going to be.
Uh-huh. Okay.
So they were able to do that kind of stuff, you know.
So was there something about veiling faces? JT, did you mention something about veiling faces?
What it was about when it's time to pray.
Show us, Lady C.
Ready, JT.
Okay. Okay. If
you gotta put a napkin over your head.
It's the head covering doctrine. If a woman were to pray in front of a man, this is what she has to put on her head. And so what happens is most Jehovah's Witness women, they always keep like a little nice scarf or a little hanky. But if you ain't got nothing, you just grab toilet paper. Just grab
you
some toilet paper, baby.
Or a diaper. My dad came home one day.
Oh, my God.
My dad wasn't a witness. And he came home from work. And my mom was doing a Bible study or something. And she was about to pray or something. And she put her napkin over her head. And my dad came in the house and said, "What are you guys sitting around with all these napkins on your head?" We started laughing. Because he wasn't baptized or nothing like that, but we were still showing respect for a male being in the house.
Yeah, it's pretty bad. Let me give you a perfect example of just how bad it is. If Jehovah's Witnesses are having a meeting and there are no men there, there are no men, but there's a little young child. He's 9 years old. He's baptized. You could have witness women who have been witnesses for 25, 35, 45 years. He actually tops all of them.
Right.
Yeah. And it's very embarrassing. It's very humiliating for women, especially if you have women who have some education. When you have to have men who may not really qualify. We had a sister in our hall. She's a doctor. She's a clinical psychologist. She was a doctor before she became a witness. And she had brought one of her fellow doctors to our meeting once. And this was a small meeting. It's called a book study where it's held in someone's home. So it's only maybe 15 or 20 people there. And she had someone there. And that night, this person was not a witness. And so that night, my reader, he's a brother who reads the pages or reads the paragraphs for them at the meeting. And I ask the questions. He reads the paragraph. Well, he didn't show up that night. So there was another brother. He's a wonderful guy, just a wonderful guy. But he's not very well educated. And he cannot read that well. But he's a brother. So I had to allow him to read. And it was really bad. I mean, it was really bad. These Bible teeth, it was really bad. So she came to me a few days at another meeting. She says, "Brother JT, I brought my friend there." And, you know, it was kind of hard because her friend was a doctor like she was. And she was wondering, why don't this guy use some of these women here to read? Because this guy can't read. But that's the way the system is set up. So we will sacrifice the quality of the meeting because he's a male. And that's what happened. Mm. And so when you are part of a male culture, religion, men are in charge, women are not, it takes many different forms. Mm-hmm. It can go, and it does. And it goes from one extreme to the other. I mean, there are elders and brothers who are witnesses, who them and their wives, they view each other as partners. But the overall attitude of this organization is that women have their place. You need to know your place and stay in your place. And like my wife mentioned, don't be coming with no ideas. In fact, it's so bad that the Watchtower has stated years ago that, for example, if your husband gives the wrong answer, as a wife, it would not be proper to correct it. Let it go. Just let your husband be a fool out there. Let it go. Don't try to save him. Just let him go on over the cliff. And so I told my wife, I said, if you see me acting like a fool or doing something stupid or saying something crazy, let me know. Don't just let me hang out there and dry. But this organization says, sister, just let the man hang out there and dry.
We had went to brunch with a couple of couples, and they weren't Jehovah's Witnesses. This is after we had left. And I remember we had been gone for a couple of years. And so, you know, the training was still like deeply ingrained in my mind. So the one couple was there, and the wife was disagreeing with the husband in public. Mm. I'm looking around at the other lady at the table, and I'm thinking maybe somebody gonna say something to her in a second because she didn't stop talking to her husband like that. You know, and I'm thinking, oh my gosh, she's embarrassing. You know, but then I realized they were just talking about the food.
Yeah.
Mm. They were having a disagreement.
You're right. She's right. I mean, it takes so many different levels. But overall, at the end of the day, women have their place and men have their place.
Yeah.
And if you get out of that place, you will get checked as a female. You will.
It is mind blowing.
You got to dumb yourself down. I felt like you had to dumb yourself down in order for people to not look at you and think that you were sidestepping or getting out of your boundaries.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It is mind blowing to me that in 2021, there's any organization, let alone a Christian religion, that is barring women from full leadership and full participation. And the Catholic Church has it. The Mormon Church has it. Jehovah's Witnesses have it. It's just mind-blowing. It's just, but thank you so much for answering that question. I have a huge favor to ask you guys, and I'm putting you on the spot.
Go ahead.
Our time is up, and I have at least another hour's worth of questions for you guys. Is there any chance you guys would be willing to come back on the podcast and let me ask you some final questions? Because we haven't covered racism yet. I'm dying to know if the Jehovah's Witness religion has a history of racism, because the Mormon Church sure does, and if there are racist policies or practices today. And then I want to talk about how the church is doing, what's causing people to leave the church, how the church is dealing with people that are leaving, how the church is dealing with the internet. And then I'm totally dying to know what it's like to be a ex-Jehovah's Witness activist. What are the upside? What's the downside? Do you guys get attacked? Are you guys ever, in the firing line like I am and like other people are? And then I want to talk about how we can collaborate and help each other, because I think we can learn a lot from each other and help each other be more successful. I know that I have a lot, I don't know if you know this, I have a lot of Jehovah's Witnesses that listen to Mormon Stories podcast. Did you guys know that?
Oh yeah, because it's almost like first cousins.
Yeah, exactly.
We share so many of the same commonalities in terms of how these organizations run, the rules of the organization.
Right.
And when you take a step back, you can quickly realize this is very similar to what I, and because like you've been saying throughout this whole program, man, I can relate. And it's because, and what it is, you will find that it's because the same techniques of these groups are used.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They change the colors, they change the outside appearance, but underneath the skin, you got the same product.
Absolutely.
Mm. Yeah. So you guys will come back?
Absolutely.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. We will always.
Okay. Just like 1 or 2 hours more, and I won't bug you anymore. But also, I just want to say, I know my listeners are going to love this. My viewers are going to love this. You guys are so delightful. You're funny. You're interesting. You're brilliant. You guys are the best. So JT and Lady C, I am so in love with you guys and what you do. And thank you so much on behalf of our listeners. Thanks for what you do for your people, but also for our people. And I can't wait to have you back.
Absolutely. We can't wait to come back.
Yeah. If there's anything that we can leave, is to let people know, regardless of what group you may be in, there is always life afterwards. Mm-hmm. It's always life.
So life after what?
It's always life afterwards.
After the religion.
Yeah, right. Okay.
It's always life after the religion. So we tell people, take the lemons and make lemonade.
Okay. And we're going to talk about that. Like, what are the lessons you've learned about how to leave a high demand religion and to heal and grow and even thrive after you've left something? It feels devastating to leave it. How do you leave it and end up thriving? That's a really important topic.
That's probably the challenge that every person faces who leaves.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. So thank you. I adore you guys. I'm sorry I have to run. We're going to bring you back for part two. And then I want you guys to give me a big old list of what I can do to help you guys. Is that okay?
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. We appreciate being on.
Thanks for the invite.
Make your list and we'll be coming right back and doing more great stuff. Tell us your website and your YouTube channel one more time.
XJWCriticalThinker.com and it's XJW. XJWCriticalThinker.com is the website. And then go to YouTube and it's just XJW Critical Thinker.
Okay. You guys are the best. We'll see you. Let's email about when we'll have you guys back.
Recording okay. Schedules.
Thank you. And again, Jason Moore, thank you so much for recommending JT and Lady C. You guys not only didn't disappoint, you guys dramatically blew away my expectations. You guys are the best. I wish Mormons had you guys. So now they do.
Now they do.
All right, you guys take care.
We'll have a good evening. Take care.
We'll see you guys soon. And listeners, join us again. We'll be doing more great stuff on Mormon Stories. Thanks to everyone who gave comments today. Your comments were amazing. Okay. Everyone take care, and we'll see you guys again soon on Mormon Stories Podcast. Take care, everybody.
Bye-bye. See you later. Bye-bye.